Ladies and gentlemen, the show is about to start in 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
He'll be fine on the mountain.
Time for Inside the Gamecocks, the show! Built by the Barnuminium Company, served by Chicken Cock Whiskey, and part of the Chief Sports Network.
Touchdown, Carolina! Touchdown, Ace Sanders! Pressure! Penny just dives in!
All right, greetings and good morning. Welcome aboard and welcome home and welcome to D's Wings inside the Gamecocks, the show live from the Sinorama Studios, both here in our studios and then on the road, like JC is today at D's Wings. Sinorama is not too far away. Sinorama.com, located in West Columbia, South Carolina, the preferred sign partner of your South Carolina Gamecocks. Also built by the Barn Dominium Company. The Barndo Co. is what they're called. The BarnDominiumCo.com to build your dream home in the Carolinas, or if you live in Georgia, or if you live in Tennessee. If you're going to build, check them out first, the BarnDominiumCo.com. And served by Chicken Cock, Chicken Cock Bourbon, providing a sweet taste this March Madness season. As your Gamecocks are set to play up in Pittsburgh on Thursday, Derek Scott will join us in the noon hour to preview that game against Oregon, and then also to discuss the rest of the tournament and much, much more moving forward. Coming up in 15 minutes, we'll be joined by Hale McGranahan. Spring practice is underway. Today is the first day of spring. Good day for it. It's chilly, but it's sunny, and that's what matters. JC joining us live from D's Wings in West Columbia, and it sounds like they're already cranking up for lunch in there, my man.
Yeah, first time I've been into the West Columbia location. West Columbia in general has grown a whole lot since right on the riverbank since I've lived here. Beautiful area. Got a chance to spend some time with one of the owners earlier today, and they're excited about this location and the business they've been doing in the neighborhood in general. Lots of growth going on. If you're in Columbia, want to come down and see me, got some free gifts to give away. If you download the Chief Sports app, show me you have, and show me you've entered our bracket challenge. I got some vintage Carolina Rise t-shirts, and those are still active. Got a Chief Sports hat. And the main. Sorry about that. The main thing is for probably the first one that comes in here and that's entered the bracket challenge, I've got, courtesy of Garnet Trust, by the way, I've got a signed Xavier Legette mini helmet. So you come in here. Now you got to eat. You can't just come in here and show me you've entered the bracket challenge and leave. So you got to sit down and eat. But if you come show me you've downloaded the Chief Sports app and entered our bracket challenge, first one to do it gets a free signed Xavier Legette mini helmet, courtesy of Garnet Trust. So that's kind of the prize closet we have today as best we could. But as we do more of these, we'll certainly have more of a prize closet. Would love to meet all of you guys, certainly in person. So come on down to D's and come on down to. Come on D's Wings and have some lunch.
Have you eaten yet this morning? Or are you waiting to eat after the show?
I might eat afterward because I don't want to get messy.
That would be the best advertisement they could have.
That's right.
There's this place in Georgia called Shane's Barbecue. It's a chain, and their tagline was, "It's going to get messy." Mm-hmm. I never thought it was all that messy. It was actually disgusting, but as barbecue goes. But anyway,
that's all right. That's all right. You're making me hungry just thinking about the fact that you're at D's. D's, as he pointed out, the bracket challenge is available on the Chiefs Sports app. I think I checked it earlier this morning. I think there's 30 something folks that have registered to participate in our bracket challenge, which D's Wings is helping us present to you as well. Hopefully you'll stop in and watch. There's plenty of TVs there to watch March Madness and watch your Gamecocks at 4 o'clock on Thursday take on Jermaine Cousinard and the Oregon Ducks. As I mentioned, plenty on that coming up with Derek Scott in just a little while. But yeah, D's is somebody said it yesterday in the chat box, how large their menu is, and they're right. And I've had many of the items on that menu, but it is just impossible for me to go to D's Wings and not get, you know, wings. So hopefully whoever heads that way will do the same.
Like that steam pot thing, like the crab and the low country boil stuff.
Yeah.
I always have had my eye on that stuff, because you see somebody that looks delicious, but then you're like, but I'm sacrificing the wings.
I know.
And I'm like, yeah. And like Mike Morgan and I, we get along about just about everything. Like, you know, we rarely disagree on things, but one thing we get along with no matter what is chicken wings. Like mm-hmm. we like the no fat, no blubber, smaller version chicken wings.
And yeah.
D and place Wing Ranch close Atlanta are the best ones.
Well, so you're a flats guy?
Drums, but no fat on the drums.
Oh, you're like okay.
I'm a drums guy, but I mean, you know, that's just me. I mean, everybody has different opinions on chicken wings. Like Nat likes in Chicago, when you get chicken wings, sometimes it's an actual wing, like you get in a bucket of Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Get the whole wing
and in sauce. That freaked me out. I was like, why is there a tail? But then if you go to Hooters, you'll have the tails. I don't like that either. Yeah, so mm-hmm. Hooters actually made me into a drums man.
Okay.
You know, because of the tails. I'm just not a fan. I'm like, what's the purpose of the tail? Cut that off, please.
Yeah. Fair enough. That's fair. I mean, I'm a flats guy, but I'll take good wings anywhere. The question, we've got a question in the Banana Sports chat box. Skyland asked, D's or Carolina wings? Well, so I don't think it would be very appropriate of us to promote another wing joint over the wing joint that is also partnered with our program. So I would lie to you if I was obligated to lie to you, but I'm not going to lie. I used to be a huge Carolina wings guy. And there was a time when I thought Carolina wings, what were the best wings? Wild Wings at one point in time had the best wings. Wild Wings went downhill in a hurry. Carolina Wings, they were kind of simultaneously in the wing battle of Columbia right there in the Vista at one point in time. Carolina Wings, Wild Wings. What do you like better? And then Carolina Wings obviously had some hiccups over time with some of their business models. Wild Wings has clearly had that. And so for the last, I don't know how many years now, I always go to D's Wings. Like, I mean that wholeheartedly. I always eat D's Wings. Phil and I just had them in the press box last month up at Founders Park, and they're just fantastic. So I get it. I appreciate the question, but there's a reason why we chose D's Wings to be partners with us, and that's because they're the best. So do us a favor, JC, after we get off the air and you start chowing down, make sure that you send out a photo of just how many you ate and how messy you got.
Yeah. I don't know, man. I don't know. Maybe. I'll get at least a feeling. I've got a crazy running around day. The whole wing battle of Columbia, I decided on these long ago when I my ex-wife and I lived in the Northeast when we first started the Big Spur. We would drive into Casey, you know, passing. There was like another D's up that way that wasn't the real one. And we'd pass Carolina. their credit, their grill wing selection is, it's, but it's different. You know what I'm saying? It's different than what we get.
Yeah, well, fair. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's fair. Yep. That's fair.
But you got one thing for certain is you have to go independent when it goes to wing joints. You can't go to the chain places because it's just not nearly as good. You got to go.
Well, that's what place. That's why Wild Wing was so good.
No, I can't say Buffalo Wild Wing.
Yeah, no. It's just, yeah.
No, I mean, that's what happened to Wild Wing Cafe. I mean, they used to just be, there was only so many locations, and then they decided that they wanted to try to go national and go corporate and you know, be the big dogs. And Diane and you know, they sold it out, and it just never was this. The wings got smaller. The service wasn't very good. They didn't taste as good. It just wasn't good.
I used to, in my salad eating days, which I need to return to quickly, I got the salad. Was bacon, blue cheese, and it was a low-carb salad kind of deal. And last time I had it, it was not good. So, yeah. And I'm sorry about the Wi-Fi, guys. When we go to break, there's another one I think I can log on to.
Okay. All right. We'll check it. We'll hit a timeout in just a few minutes anyway, so we got to get Hale in. So, those of you that want to watch some basketball and eat some good food, tonight at 6:40, Wagner and Howard in the first four, a pair of 16 seeds trying to advance and play on the weekend. Colorado State and Virginia at 9:10 tonight on True TV, a pair of 10 seeds looking to advance. Colorado State is a 2.5-point favorite over the Wahoos up in Dayton, Ohio, and Howard is a 3.5-point favorite over Wagner. So those will be your basketball games that you get to watch today in the NCAA tournament if you decide to head over to D's Wings. The NIT also, though, begins today, and there are some SEC teams that will be playing. LSU's got North Texas tonight at 7 o'clock. Georgia has Xavier tonight at 7 o'clock as well. Hats off to some of these teams that have decided to actually play in the NIT, even though they weren't selected to the dance, like Providence, who's going to face Boston College. How about that? Providence and Boston College, not too far apart. Up there in the Northeast. And then there's a bunch of other ones on tonight, Utah and UC Irvine and Virginia Tech, Richmond, and so on and so forth. So there is plenty of basketball. You also might be able to catch the South Carolina baseball game on the SEC Network Plus if they'll have that. Maybe JC can check on that and see if they'll have that on TV up there. I know that Eddie Copper is going to get the ball tonight for the Gamecocks in the Upstate at 6 o'clock versus the Spartans of South Carolina Upstate. If you're going to listen to it on the radio, Cade Crenshaw and Stuart Lake will be on the call. But again, it will be streamed on ESPN Plus, and they'll have that. Hopefully, they'll have that at D's Wings. Can you check that for us, JC, to see if they'll have that on TV, the baseball game on ESPN Plus? Okay, we'll let him take a peek at that, and obviously, he's going to try to get some things figured out on the Wi-Fi front. By the way, quick nugget here. On Carolina baseball, everybody is much more focused on the fact that this team has struggled offensively to this point, and I get it, I am too, and I would agree with all of you. We are beginning to get into record watch with Ethan Petrie, because the home run that he hit in Oxford this past weekend gave him his 30th of his career, 7th of the season, but 30th of his career, which ties him for 15th all time. In that category, he's got Jeff Barnes, Christian Walker, and Jackie Bradley Jr. So the next home run he hits, he'll clear 30 home runs going. Now, I would contend and argue for both Jackie and Christian, and probably a little bit more, no offense, Jackie, but for Christian, that had they not decided to deaden the bats, that Christian Walker would have hit more than 30 home runs at South Carolina. As a matter of fact, I would bet my paycheck that he would have many more. So the next home run that Ethan Petrie will hit, whenever that is, will give him 31, and that'll tie him with Dave Hollins, Jerry Shepard, Brendan Wynn, Jacob Olson, my friend Michael Campbell, and Yaron Peters. Now, remember, Yaron hit 29 his final year at South Carolina, and then from there we'll start to bring other names into the mix. 62 is the record. Justin Smoke holds that from 06 to 08 So Ethan Petrie is beginning to climb that record board with now 30 career home runs. So we'll keep our eyes on that each time that the Gamecocks get on the field. So, JC, what we'll do is we'll go ahead and slide to a timeout here. We got Hale coming up next. Spring practice began today. I know you're going to try to work and see if you can't get a little bit better signal in there from a Wi-Fi standpoint.
Yeah, I just switched networks, so let's see if that maybe helps a little bit.
It looks good now, that's for sure. It sounds good. Sounds fantastic. So
Clark Gable over my shoulder. That's how I looked when I was 35.
Handsome fella. I'm sure that it is.
I never would have known that was Clark Gable. I thought it was you. I thought it was a headshot from back in the day.
From the last time that he ate wings 35. At D's, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Well, that's the wing championship portrait up there. I got my name on it. Yeah. Eating contest.
That's not a vest. That's a bib.
That's right. That's exactly bib. Right. Fill out your brackets during the break. Download the Chief Sports app if you haven't. It's right smack dab in the center. You also can check out the Southern Songwriters series that's coming up on Friday. Gamecocks play Thursday, guys. Friday night, they won't be playing. So you can head over to watch Patrick Davis, Drew Holcomb, Sean Mullins, and David Ryan Harris at the Chappelle Theater, southernsongwriters.com, to purchase your tickets. We're going to announce a slew of winners tomorrow. But on the Chief Sports app, you can throw your name in the hat to win some tickets to this thing, a pair of tickets. We've got 8 pair to give away. We've already announced one winner, and tomorrow we'll announce 7 more, all 8 collectively. That's also in the Chief Sports app. So make sure that you pull that up while we're on the air, and don't forget about it so somebody can win big. Maybe win the bracket challenge and then also, of course, win a pair of tickets to see. This is an awesome taping. It's going to be nationally televised to over 300 stations across the U.S. this summer. And man, it's really neat how they do this. So make sure you check that out too. We will hit a timeout. The first day of spring is upon us and the first day of spring practice. Hale McGranahan was there. The VIP notes are up, and he'll join us when we return on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Don't miss this, the final taping of season 1 of the Southern Songwriter Series with Patrick Davis is Friday, March 22nd in the Chappelle Auditorium at Allen University in Columbia. Patrick will be joined by renowned national artists and songwriters David Ryan Harris, Sean Mullins, and Drew Holcomb in this national made-for-TV event that will be broadcast on over 300 stations in the U.S. this summer. Tickets are available at southernsongwriters.com. VIP and general admission seats are available, but are moving quickly. Go see one of South Carolina's proudest musical sons, Patrick Davis, alongside a national cast of elite performers. Visit southernsongwriters.com. That's southernsongwriters.com. The Southern Songwriters Series with Patrick Davis, Friday, March 22nd. At Allen University in Columbia.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpeper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, 3 great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
Chicken cock originated in Kentucky, like so many other bourbons. And so the resurrection of it, you know, Paris, Kentucky, that's the county seat of Bourbon County. So much of this whiskey was being made in that Bourbon County, put on ships and barges and shipped down Ohio, down the Mississippi, and got to New Orleans, where it got distributed all over the world. And people kept saying, well, hey, I want some more of that whiskey from Bourbon County. And so that's how bourbon whiskey got its name. And Chicken Cock originated actually in Paris, Kentucky, which is today Bourbon County.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
Building your dream home is often just that, a dream, and sometimes a nightmare. But at the Barn Door Company, they commit to quality and build without sacrifice. Customization, open floor plans, limitless flooring options, maintenance-free and easy installation perks, and affordability are just a few reasons why they've been named one of the best builders in the U.S. Believe in your dreams. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Door Company. Gamecock owned. Gamecock operated. The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location, or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia, and go Gamecocks.
This is Inside the Gamecocks, the show. Here are your hosts, J.C. Sherbert, Bill Mullinax, and Jamie Bradford.
The great Bob Seger bringing us back from break. 11:24 on this first day of spring. J.C. Sherbert live from D's Wings in West Columbia, and Hale McGranahan somewhere just outside of a tornado, according to his hairstyle today. Good afternoon, Hale. Morning.
Hey.
Good afternoon. Morning. Good morning.
It's rock morning star. Morning in Columbia. It's windy. And it's warming up, and that's Williams Bryce behind me.
Oh, is that what that is?
Yeah, it's been a little while since November. So if you haven't been over this part of town in a while, that's what that is.
Well, last night I went to get in the car last night, and I thought I was going to blow away. It was worse than Chicago. Yeah. It was very windy here last night, and it was crazy because it was windy here, and I drove over to Casey, like West Columbia. Wasn't as windy there. Then back downtown, windy. So I don't know what the Columbia weather gods were thinking, but it is what it is. Yeah, Hale, you look like a rock star.
You do, man. Thank you. You really do.
It's on world tour. Right. Trying to live that lifestyle.
The shades. I mean, it all goes. It just all goes together.
There you go.
So Hale, all right, we're through one day of spring practice. So tell us the starting lineup on August 31st.
You. Appreciate you coming out, man.
I'm just kidding. I'm kidding.
Lenore Sellers is the quarterback, and there were 10 other guys on the field with the offense. Didn't see an entire defense at any point, at least when I was out there. So, yeah, very much a work in progress. But you know what? My biggest takeaway from today is I heard some bad words out there on the field.
Good.
Coming from some of the coaches.
Was Will Muschamp out there?
I didn't see him. I don't think
so. How about
so.
Eric Wolford?
Mm-hmm.
How
no,
about
no.
T-Rob?
Nope, no T. Well, there was a guy who could be referred to as such, but not that guy.
Tracy Rocker. No, no Tracy.
Oh, was Tracy Rocker here long enough to coach practice?
To all cuss the players? Absolutely. Absolutely he was.
Yeah,
we just didn't hear about it because it was a pandemic and nobody that season existed.
What was the energy uptick like with Sean Elliott back out there?
Well, Well, it's funny you bring up that name. It seems like we were on that subject already, JB. But, yeah, very high. Very high from Sean Elliott and Joe DeCamillis as well. But I've been in the process of trying to get a video uploaded to the Big Spur of Sean Elliott getting after some of the players during ball security drills. I posted a short little snippet on Twitter. If anyone follows me on Twitter or X, check that out.
I screwed that up, Hale, because you were trying to get the YouTube and I was trying to get the YouTube at the same time. Just text it to me. I'll put it on YouTube for you.
All right. Yeah. Technology has not been cooperative for me so far this morning.
Well, I know I saw it come through. I'm like, who is this doing this? And then I was trying to do the same thing at the same time because I'm in a strange place. So, and it doesn't recognize it. So, whatever. just text it to me. I'll get it up for you, bud.
So, obviously, the first six periods, Hale, you're not. I mean, number one, it's the first spring practice and it's the first six periods. And there's just really not much that's going to come from that. So what do you look for when you're out there on a day like today? What is it that you're searching to find?
Yeah, just seeing who's on the field and doing stuff. And obviously when you're not in pads, that's not going to be a true representation of what happened in a football game. But, you know, Marquis Anderson was on the field. Cam Pringle was on the field doing stuff. Cason Henry was on the field doing stuff. Some guys who have been banged up. Obviously, Pringle wasn't here last year, but some guys who were banged up last year and missed a good bit of time and would have been players along that offensive line. So, at the very least, it's good to see guys like that out running around and moving around and doing stuff. I mentioned seeing Lenore Sellers with the first team offense. It was interesting just to see who that first offensive line group was and who the receivers were and who else was on the field at running back and tight end and that type of thing. So at the very least, it's a baseline. It provides us that very first look of what it is right now and gives us an idea of what it could be down the road. In a lot of cases, things will change, but you know, we're just getting started here, obviously, day one.
Any new injuries or anything that you're – I know Shane's going to meet with the media in a little while, but anything on that standpoint that you could at least see to update?
Not that I could see, no.
Okay.
With Marquis and Kaysen and Cam, like I mentioned, those were a few guys that I was just curious to see where they were from a health standpoint. You know, maybe when pads come on, some of those guys aren't doing as much. That's all to be determined, but at the very least, I saw those guys, and that's about all I can say at this point. Because the way things are going out there is, you know, they have the two fields next to each other, and they're moving players from one field to the next, from depending on, you know, what they're working on, what drills are happening. So, you know, where I was, I saw mostly offensive guys. The field I was on was mostly offensive guys doing stuff. When they got into actual like position drills doing the full 11 offensive players on the field.
How about the offensive line guys? The those that were freshmen last year, Big Tree, you mentioned Marquis being out there, Travon Ball. Now that they've gone through winter workouts, what'd they look like?
I thought Cam looked to be in pretty good shape. He seemed to me like he was a guy who probably could have shed a few pounds coming into Carolina in January, and I thought he looked pretty good. Once he was in pretty good shape, that's another thing. Going back to your previous question, maybe of something that you want to see is like just what kind of shape are these guys in? And it looked to me like those offensive line guys, the ones that you're asking about, seem to be in pretty good shape from a you know. A weight standpoint, I guess you could say.
Okay. How about the running back position? I know, obviously, they're a little banged up there, but still a bunch of transfers. Oscar Attaway, Juwan Howell, did you see him on the field? What did DJ Braswell look like from a size standpoint? He was a guy who needed to probably gain some weight in the offseason. Anything stand out there?
No, not really. I mean, I those guys were kind of up close to me for about a minute or so. but nothing that really, you know, jumps out immediately to my in my mind.
Hale McGranahan joining us from outside of spring practice. The building behind him is a place called Williams-Brice Stadium. They'll play football there on August the 31st after they play football there on August the 3rd, but that would be the soccer brand of football. JC, I know you had, you're getting some noise in there, but jump in wherever you want to, my man. Obviously, if there's, I know you got some things on your mind you wanted to ask Hale, who's poured vodka into his Gatorade bottle today. So.
There's no vodka in here.
Oh.
Right. Well, that's what you answer that quickly, very quickly. Yeah, but it, so does it look? So I guess you kind of answered this earlier. Sellers taking snaps with the ones. Shane said that before they started practice. Anybody at receiver? I know they were running away from you guys per the updates, and I haven't read your insider story yet. So if it's in there, forgive me. But anybody at receiver, maybe? New guys, Lava Day, Brown, anybody catch your eye?
You guys got to understand something. We don't we don't see a whole lot out there, so no. Yeah. I mean, it's the they caught some passes from Mike Furry about 60 yards away from us, and they weren't going against anybody. They weren't even really running routes. They were just kind of going through lines like warming up. I mean,
routes on air. Yeah. Okay.
Not even that. Not even that. They're just loosening up, really. It's and a lot of special.
Well, then, yeah, you can tell absolutely nothing.
No.
Lots of special teams. You did mention this. You mentioned Joe D. Camillus, and I think a lot of times fans, like when he was in the NFL, and I said this on the show, that Joe D. is a fiery, you know, he's a special teams coach. You know, he's fired up all the time. And was one of the most demonstrative coaches in the NFL. I think as he's 57 years old and coming in here, maybe some people don't think he's going to bring that same passion. But you mentioned it earlier. Tell us about his demeanor out there working with everybody. And, you know, is he kind of a barker? Is he a high, what you call a high energy guy? How would you compare him to Sean Elliott? That kind of thing.
I think they're kind of cut from the same cloth. I mean, they were the special teams drills they were going through. I think the very first thing they lined up and did was just had the protection units for field goals. And they weren't even kicking the ball. They were just, I guess, working on their steps and who's supposed to go where when they're blocking and all that kind of stuff. And seems very, you know, basic type of deal, right? And I heard Joe DeCamillis getting after some guys because for whatever reason he wasn't pleased with what he was seeing from them, and I think that sort of speaks to what you're asking there. JC is he's definitely a guy who's high energy and he gets fired up, and much like Pete Limbo, but in a different type of demeanor, I guess you could say. He takes his job very seriously. I mean, when you're talking about the second team field goal block unit, not stepping right or doing something, probably a very minor detail, and he's getting after this kid or player in the first day of practice. I think that just sort of speaks again to a guy who takes this stuff pretty seriously.
How about Mike Furry? Doesn't he fit that mold as well?
I would think so. Yeah, but you know, it been nothing that really stood out from that
time. His Twitter account's like professional wrestling every morning. Yeah. Let's get up and celebrate the sunshine. Woo! Brother, it's a great day. I mean, that gets me fired up. I think it fires up Shane Beamer, quite frankly. Beamer retweets it like every morning. But, yeah, I mean, you know, I don't know. You got a last name like Fury. I mean,
good point.
If my last – if I was JC Firework or Firecracker, I would think I would be a little spunky. So if my last name's Fury, I would think I would be, you know, furious or, you know, with Fury.
I think one of the things I'm most interested to learn from Shane Hale is how different or similar or what changes they'll be making this spring. And what I mean by that is just how they're going to work through all the way through the spring game from a developmental standpoint, because you have clearly he's going into his fourth year as the head coach here. So he's been through spring ball a few times, and we've talked to him about this a couple times on our programming, at least, how he self-evaluates everything, right? And he goes back and he looks, and he makes phone calls. He talks to people, tries to figure things out. He's got a little circle that's on this staff that helps him do that. But now he's also – that circle has changed a little bit with the additions of the guys you just mentioned, Joe DeCamillis, Mike Fury, Sean Elliott being back and understanding this program, Markel Blackwell being here. But they all – I mean, think about that, right, Hale? Joe comes from the NFL. So, obviously, he's seen it and done it differently. They don't have spring ball in the NFL, you know. So he's seen things and done things differently from a developmental standpoint. You're talking about Sean Elliott, who ran his own program at Georgia State. What did he learn that he wants to bring back maybe as a head coach and pass that forward to Coach Beamer? Markel Blackwell, all the guys he's worked with. Mike Fury is a former head coach. Like, I feel like there's a lot of differing opinions that will go into the game plan this spring to develop this football team. I'm really interested to hear what he's got to say about that.
Yeah, we'll be talking to him here in about an hour and have some stuff to ask him about, and we'll certainly be interesting to hear what he has to say about his new coaches now that he's gotten to be around them a little bit more and spend some time on the field with them.
Did you get any kind of look at the running backs at all?
Hale. Yeah, Joe asked me that. I saw him, you know, for a little bit there in front of me for about a minute. But
anybody missing?
They walked out of the locker room.
Was everybody there except Rocket?
I think everybody was there. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Yeah. It's certainly interesting. And of course, Hale, naturally, we've gone through a week of 80-degree days. So the morning you get to walk out to spring practice, it's 40 degrees, right? Wasn't that what it was?
41, yeah. Of course it would be like that. Yeah.
That's what the football gods are here for, you know. It's the same thing with baseball when they start things. So what they will be, what are they doing? Tuesday, Thursday? Is that it? Tuesday, Thursday, and then they'll scrimmage three times before they play on April 20th. Is that correct?
I need to pull up the schedule in front of me, but this week, you know, they practice today. I'm not sure if they're back on the field tomorrow or not. We get to interview the coordinators tomorrow, and I think they practice again on Thursday. I can't remember. I remember things based off of when we've gotten to be over here and doing stuff. So I can't speak to exactly what the schedule looks like, but I think they scrimmage twice, then do the spring game. I think that's how it goes.
You mentioned there was you said two. Was there two teams or three teams or from the offensive standpoint? They rolled out one, two, and third teams. Is that correct?
That's right. Yeah. Yep.
Who was the second team quarterback?
Robbie Ashford, and the third team quarterback was Davis Bevel.
How Bevel looked throwing the football? Did you see anything there?
Again, we
not much.
We don't see anything.
I'm gonna say Davis Bevel. I just hope if he has to play, I just pray to God he just plays on just a lot better. He was bad, but Oklahoma bad. I mean, I watched most of that Oklahoma-Texas game. His day was in Kentucky. We were in a sports bar. And they put him in. And I was like, holy crap, it's Davis Bevel. Because I didn't know he was even at Oklahoma. He was at Greenville High School. I watched him play high school. I thought when he went to Pitt, that was a good idea because they got drop-back passers and seven-step drops, protection, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I do think he's got arm talent. I do think if he gets time, he can throw the ball. But, man, I mean, even if this offensive line is night and day better, you're in the SEC, you're going to give up pressure. That's not an ideal situation. You're going to, you know, but I understand why they took it. I understand why they took it because you need – it's good to have, you know, experience depth out there.
He's also a walk-on.
He's a walk-on, right?
Yeah, he is a walk-on. He's not on scholarship.
Was Reno at practice? Did you see Reno out there?
I I don't know, guys. I mean, I can't go through the entire roster and answer who was there and who wasn't there. It's hard to do.
What about the eighth string kicker? Did you happen to see
him?
Eighth string kicker. Oh, the 10th string kicker. I was missing. Didn't get the ninth or the seventh. Maybe the eighth.
Okay. I mean, backup long snapper info. I mean, come on.
Is Chris Payne from Columbia High making it into the school this year?
That's right. There you go.
Jarvis Giles. Hale,
Jarvis Giles.
Any visitors that were on campus today? I think you had reported some of this in the VIP room last night. That were planning to be at the first practice of significance. Anybody that you saw out there that you had reported on?
Yeah, Jordan Gidron, the receiver from Ridgeview, 2026 receiver. That's Holman Thomas, offensive lineman, so 2025 from Jacksonville, committed to Florida State. He was there.
Wow.
Guys from Irmo as well.
What's the deal with Solomon Thomas, Hale? The last I looked at his player profile via 24/7 Sports, he was a top 20 five-star prospect nationally in the composite. You said he's committed to Florida State. Do you have any idea of what his interest level is with the Gamecocks?
It's pretty high. I mean, he's been here before, and he's stayed in contact with the coaching staff. I mean, he's talking to a lot of folks besides Florida. In South Carolina, for that matter. So he's pretty wide open as far as like where his recruiting's at. South Carolina's involved, but they're a lot.
Wasn't he originally projected as a defensive lineman, or no? Am I remembering that wrong?
There's a Solomon Thomas who played defensive line for the 49ers.
Yeah.
Played at Stanford. Yeah, from Texas. We had him top five in the country. Oh, so this Solomon Thomas is definitely an offensive lineman. So
yeah, he's a big boy.
See what happens.
6'4", 320. Oh, is he really? Yeah, he is. Hey, we'll let you run. I've got one more prospect I want to ask you about. A 25 kid out of Irmo, AJ Brand. I've never seen this young man play football. I'm sure you probably have. I know if you go look at his player rating and all that type of stuff, it's fairly low, but. From what I've heard, they really do like this young man. Can you describe him as a football player and why South Carolina is interested in his game?
Yeah, he's sort of like a DQ Smith, plays quarterback at Irmo, and he's got some interest from some places to play quarterback in college. I don't think that would be in his future at South Carolina. Probably again like DQ Smith, but possibly as a safety. He's about 6'1", 195 pounds. He's well put together. He's a good football player. I don't know, like, how fast he would run in a 40. I'm curious to see what he would do in a combine type setting, just because I genuinely don't know what those numbers are. But one thing that I saw from him at a 7-on-7 a few weeks ago is he went and dunked a football on a goalpost. Which is pretty impressive for anybody to do, right? I mean, it's like 10 feet. And it wasn't just like him getting up there and like barely like getting it over the bar. Like he was like looking down on the bar and throwing the ball down. So that just sort of, I guess, speaks to his athleticism and sort of, to me, indicates that whenever he does a combine type of thing, that he's probably going to put up some pretty good numbers. He's an explosive athlete. So I think he's a good player and an under-recruited guy for some reason, doesn't have a ton of offers, but somebody who I think's a pretty good football player.
Probably a guy, asking you two recruiting gurus, you and JC, probably a guy who whatever he does in camp this summer and then early in the fall in his season, probably a guy who's going to start to move up from a recruiting standpoint, I would imagine, right? Didn't he kind of fit that mold?
It depends. I don't know. I think a lot of times analysts have their mind made up on a kid and kind of depends on where they – I don't know. You tell me, Hale.
Yeah, I think for him, going back to the combine type thing, that's an important aspect when it comes to evaluating guys for ratings and stars and all that, because it matters, quite frankly. And there's a reason that the NFL – test these guys when they're figuring out if they're going to draft them, to see how athletic they are and how fast they are. I mean, you can look athletic and run fast and look like you're running fast on tape, but if it doesn't match up with what you do and a testing type setting, maybe there's some reason to be concerned. I think AJ Brand's a good football player. I really do like him, and whether he's playing quarterback at a place like Old Dominion in college or playing safety across the street for South Carolina, I think he's going to be successful. For him, again, it goes back to the combine stuff. What can he do that way? Because he's probably going to be an athlete at the highest level of college football, and probably that's probably his best shot to get drafted in the NFL is playing somewhere other than quarterback. Maybe he proves me wrong and proves some other folks wrong, but probably the coaches in South Carolina since they're recruiting him as an athlete. But I think for him, to sort of answer your question, JB, is if he can put up some impressive numbers, again, I hate to belabor this point, if he could put up some impressive numbers at a combine, like his rating could improve before he – as a senior season at Irma. He had a really, really productive junior season there. He only had a couple interceptions and threw for a bunch of yards, rushed for over 1,000, had a ton of touchdowns. Like, he'll probably put up similar type of numbers because they've got a good team around him. He plays for his dad's the coach, so like they've got a pretty good thing going on over there. So I'm sure he'll have a great senior season and all that. For him, it's going to be, from a rating standpoint, going to be more about what he can do here this spring at some national combine.
Hale, we can't. I had one more thing. I had written this down from last night. This was something you put out in the VIP room. For those that have not checked yet, make sure you head to the bigspur.com and read the VIP notes from Hale and Whittle and all those guys. Really interesting kind of story that you plugged in there last night about a young man from Sumter named, I believe it's Terrion Grant, a 4-star cornerback. I don't want to give everything away necessarily, as we have, clearly are going to encourage people to go read your report on this. But so he, to be clear, he doesn't live here, but he's from Sumter. What's the story here? It sounds like South Carolina just started recruiting him. Can you fill us in a little bit?
Yeah, so he did an interview with The Athletic last week, and before he came out, where he was quoted saying that he liked South Carolina and would have considered South Carolina before he committed to Purdue. So that apparently got the attention of the South Carolina staff because he got an offer from the Gamecocks late Friday afternoon, early Friday night, and they're recruiting him now. He's in the Nashville area at Siegel High School in Murfreesboro, which is the same high school as Joseph Anderson, where he played his last year of high school ball before he signed with South Carolina in like 2019 under Muschamp and them. So yeah, this guy, he was born in Sumter and he lived there till he was like 5 or 6. So it's not like he just moved to Tennessee. So I think some folks were maybe a little harder on the coaching staff than they needed to be when it came to this particular story and this fella who now has an offer from Carolina. They don't really recruit the Nashville area like the previous coaching staff did. They're not sending multiple coaches into the Nashville area every time they can have coaches at high school. So, right. You know what? They didn't know about a kid who moved from Sumter when he was in maybe the first grade and now lives outside of Nashville. So they've offered him now. He's number 5 ranked cornerback in the country, according to 24/7. He's committed to Purdue. Apparently Alabama's offered and pushing for him. Same with Florida State. South Carolina's there too. So we'll see where this thing goes from here. But he does have legit interest in Carolina, and I think it's pretty mutual.
Wow, big kid, 6'3", 175 pounds, according to his profile on 247sports.com. The composite has him as the 36th ranked prospect nationally. Be an interesting and big-time pickup for Shane Beamer and his staff if they could get that done somehow down the line. Hey, we'll let you run. I know you probably got to squeeze some lunch in, and then you got to get to a press conference here in just a little while with Coach Beamer. So we'll all be glued to the big spur as you begin to roll your reports out a little bit later on this afternoon, my man. Thanks a lot.
All right, boys. Appreciate y'all.
All right. There you go. Hale McGranahan with the big spur from right outside of Williams-Brice Stadium and between the Steve and Jerry Spurrier indoor facility. So coming up at 12:20, we've got Derek Scott, the voice of Gamecock basketball. Hale, Phil, I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll hit a timeout at 11:55. Let's hit a timeout at 11:55 here because we do have some major breaking national news involving the team from the, or the, I should say the school from the upstate as it pertains to their future and the ACC. JC, what's, what are you hearing as far as Clemson goes?
Yeah, this lawsuit got emailed to me about 10 minutes ago. And I was sitting there reading through it. Clemson has joined Florida State in suing the ACC. Their lawsuit's not with Florida State. It's separate. And just reading through it, I think they got a really good case, to be honest with you. I mean, it's it kind of takes the withdrawal fees and all that stuff is unenforceable and unreasonable and astronomical, and that the damages that have been done to Clemson because of it in other words, they're being damaged by this. And you know, it takes a kind of an interesting approach to the sense that within the conference, there's nothing in the bylaws or the constitution of the conference or anything like that that would, you know, prevent a team from leaving. Or, you know, it's not, I think they're taking the approach that it's not, I guess, that it's unconstitutional, if that makes sense, as it relates to the ACC. It's filed in the state of South Carolina, Nelson Mullins, Riley, and Scarborough. They're powerful bunch of attorneys here in Columbia are representing them. So this is interesting because this also tells me that Clemson's got some options, we all should care about because it's our state. You know, I mean, people can, you know, our fans can, you know, put their head in the sand, but that matters, you know, where they go and where they end up.
Yeah, right now, so it was filed in Pickens County, and you just mentioned Nelson Mullins and those guys who've got it. It's correct me if I'm wrong, to depart the Atlantic Coast Conference, member institutions at this point in time would have to pay $140 million, correct?
No, it's that's the exit fee, but
that's the exit fee.
You also have to turn over your TV money till 2036. Yeah, it's like $500 million. I mean,
okay, so fiduciary duties on top of the exit fee. So yeah, you're talking about $400 or $500 million.
Mm-hmm. And the claim in the lawsuit is that those fiduciary duties are just made up, that they don't exist. I don't know. It's going to be very interesting. Usually, plaintiffs in these college suits have won. You know, and there's kind of an opinion in the courts to kind of tear it all down, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
I don't, honest to God, I know Clemson agreed to it, Clint, but that's fine. But I think things have changed so dramatically. The ACC is really stupid to hold everybody to it. I mean, because it's unrealistic. I mean, it's, you know, so anyway. That's what's going on. That's a piece of national news originating from the state and the state of South Carolina. And we'll see what happens there. But that tells me Clemson does have some options outside of just staying in the ACC, because I don't think they would have gone down this road had they not.
Yeah, they've certainly been working this behind the scenes. Florida State has been out in front of it for quite some time, as we all know. So we'll talk about those options when we return. What are they, and what would they mean to the future of Clemson athletics, and what would they mean to people like South Carolina and others that surround the Tigers? We've got Derek Scott coming up as well. We got some baseball to touch on in just a little while, so it's going to be another busy day, as it always is here on Inside the Gamecocks show. JC is live from Bees Wings in West Columbia. Have you given away the helmet yet?
No, nobody's come up and said anything. The owner, Billy, came by the table and said hello earlier, but nobody's dropped by just yet. So we will, if we don't get rid of the helmet today, we will maybe save it for a bracket winner or something. But certainly would like to give it away today. And, you know, if you guys come by, I mean, we're an hour into lunch, so we'll see if somebody stops by the old table over here. They may not want to be they may not want to bother me, so that may be we may get some traffic here at the break.
If you are en route, and we know many of you listen to us while you're out driving around, JC has a signed mini helmet by Xavier Leggett. And would love to give it away to the first person that comes up, shows him the Chief Sports app, and that they have entered. You have entered the bracket challenge
and the bracket contest. It's courtesy of Garnet Trust too. So, very thankful for Jeremy and Mark for hooking us up with that earlier today.
Nonetheless, if you miss the helmet, eat some wings at D's where JC is. Maybe grab you an app sampler or some Irish nachos. If you haven't had their Irish nachos, they are pretty darn good. Their buffalo chicken ranch melt is also good. Now my mouth is watering. So we're going to have to step aside, Phil, so we can clean ourselves up here. Hang tight. Inside the Gamecocks, the show live from D's Wings. We'll be right back.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
It's the season of love, and there's no sweeter time and place to feel it than today at Love Chevrolet. The heart-pounding rumble of the Silverado High Country. The captivating 2024 Chevy Trax SUV, most affordable in its class. No matter what features you're looking for in a brand new Chevy, your match is waiting for you right now at Love Chevy. In this 63rd season of love, your trusted hometown Chevy dealer is proud to carry on the tradition of honesty, integrity, and treating customers like family. No fast talk, no gimmicks, no ridiculous add-on stickers. Simply the best selection of new Chevys at South Carolina's number one volume Chevy dealer right now and ready to drive home today. Don't forget about the $1,000 low price guarantee. Wow, there's a lot to love about Love Chevy. I-26 at Harbison and at lovechevy.com. Together, let's drive.
Hey Gamecock fans, this is Roman Kimball with South Carolina Baseball. My friends over at Electric Bikes of Charleston have the largest selection of e-bikes in South Carolina. You can cruise up to high speeds of 28 miles per hour, which is about 70 miles an hour slower than my fastball. Stay in shape and enjoy your life with an electric bike from Electric Bikes of Charleston, where buyers come from all across South Carolina. Visit electricbikescharleston.com. See you at the ballpark, and go Gamecocks.
Hey Gamecock Nation, my name is Kyle, longtime listener of the show and avid golfer. I wanted to take my game to the next level, but let's face it, golf is a hard game to learn on your own. I heard the ad from McKellar Enterprises and reached out to the owner and former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. In just 2 months of working with Meredith, I shot my lowest round ever, and I've never felt more confident in my golf game. So if you're looking to take your game to the next level, go to McKellarEnterprises.org and book your lesson today with former Gamecock golfer, Meredith Taylor. Go Gamecocks.
It's 2024, and it's time to get in shape. Charleston Fitness Equipment can help you do just that in Mount Pleasant. The Wilkins family, big Gamecock fans and proud supporters of Carolina Rise and our programming on the Chief Sports Network. But most importantly, proud supporters of you getting healthy and staying healthy. CharlestonFitnessEquipment.com. Find them on the Chief Sports app and in Mount Pleasant. Happy New Year.
Hey, Gamecock fans, Mike Morgan here. During my time in Colombia, one of my favorite places to eat was Salsarita's. When I go back now for work or any other reason, it's still Salsarita's. Yeah, I'm like you. I love tacos. I love Tex-Mex. Where are you going to go to get them? Well, you've got two convenient Salsarita's locations, one in Lexington at the Target Center and one in West Colombia as well. Now, if you like tailgating, and who doesn't? Whether it's for a football game or anything else, they've got the catering hotline. Get yourself some Fiesta packs to take tailgating. Get yourself the Three Amigos bundles for tailgating. They make catering easy with a fresh, hot setup. And again, you just call the phone number 803-543-6297 to set it up. You can also look them up online, or you can even download the app. Salsarita's is just a cut above the rest. That's why they're serving Williams-Brice Stadium and the South Stands, also serving in the Colonial Life Arenas. Again, that catering hotline number, make it easy for you and the folks out there. You don't need to settle for sandwiches every time. 803-543-6297. 803-543-6297.
Rescues and Resin, proud supporters of Carolina Rise. They are also proud partners of the show. They make products you can't get anywhere else. Custom designed wood and resin products that make your tailgate, make your home, or make anything stand out. Order a custom cutting board, coasters, wall art, tables, and more. Contact Dustin and Tabitha at rescuesandresin.com today. Rescuesandresin.com, and put your imagination to work. Rescues and Resin, proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Billy G's Carolina Barbecue presents the national anthem at noon every day here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show, always live from the Cinerama Studios. Billy G's Carolina Barbecue can be found this Friday night at Founders Park, weather permitting once again. Deep down the right field line and in foul territory is where their truck will be, and it is for every home game at Founders Park throughout the rest of the season. Billy G's Carolina Barbecue offers things like the Big Tex, the Big Porker, the Mac Attack, which is smoked macaroni and cheese topped with brisket or pulled pork and their sweet heat sauce and so on and so forth. Of course, you can order all that in catering as well if you go to BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com. Do you maybe have a graduation party or a birthday party or an anniversary party or any party, anything? Maybe you've got the start of summer party coming up here in just a few weeks, and you want their food truck out there, you just need their catering. BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com. I know that many of you order already from CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com. Those that don't, listen up, listen closely. CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com is where you can order the Carolina Gold, the Sweet Heat, and the Secret Spice Rub, and they'll deliver it to your home. So all the food that you make that's pretty bland and everybody says it tastes good, but it really doesn't, they just say that to make you feel better. You can put this stuff on it, and that'll change the game. Then it'll actually taste good, and nobody's lying to you anymore. CarolinaBarbecueSauce.com. J.C. Sherbert joining us from D's Wings in West Columbia, where You should join him because there are some giveaways, including a Xavier Leggett mini Carolina signed helmet. But you got to show them that you've downloaded our Chief Sports app, which thousands of you have done, and we can't thank you enough for that. And you also have to be able to prove that you're participating in our March Madness bracket, which is right there on the app. If you haven't filled your bracket out yet, go ahead and please do that. And then stop in and get some wings or maybe a buffalo chicken wrap, JC, or maybe a buffalo chicken ranch melt sandwich or a grinder or some. What else? What else is there? What have I not had there in a while? The bassa bites, the fish, little fish nuggets that they serve as appetizers. Mm-hmm. Now it's all at these wings, and it's March Madness. And it's a great place.
I don't know about fish nuggets. Yeah, there's a crowd. There's a regular crowd shuffling in here. It looks good. I went to had to go to the restroom during the last break, and I walked by the tables, and boy, it smells delicious. So. Come on down to D's Wings, West Columbia. Like I said, got a mini helmet to give away. Also got a snazzy Chief Sports trucker hat for those of you. As long as it fits your head, it doesn't fit some people's heads, but it fits most people's heads. And T-shirts, stuff like that. Come on down. We'd love to see your smiling faces here at D's in West Columbia.
We've got Derek Scott coming up in 13 minutes, a full preview of South Carolina's march into March. They'll hit the road today or the skies for Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where they'll see the Oregon Ducks at 4:00 on Thursday in the opening round of the 2024 NCAA men's basketball tournament. But the breaking news of the day is Clemson and their lawsuit being filed. JC, I just mentioned this and got into it a little bit. Filing against the ACC. So there's a couple of things here, JC, that I've been able to pick up on that they are including in this lawsuit. And one is that Clemson is arguing that the grant of rights with the league should not mean that the ACC owns those rights if they depart the league. Basically, what they're saying is you can own our rights, essentially our media rights, right? Our television rights, while we're a part of the ACC. But if we depart, the ACC should not have any hand in any ownership of those rights through 2036, which is, I guess, the nation's understanding of what this grant of rights actually means for the league and what it has meant for quite some time since everybody signed it. They also included in this lawsuit the withdrawal penalties from the other major leagues left in college athletics. There is not a withdrawal penalty in the Big Ten. It is nothing. The SEC, it's a $30 million penalty if you give 2 years' notice that you will be departing the Southeastern Conference. It's a $40 million penalty if you give less than 2 years' notice that you're departing the Southeastern Conference. And if you don't give any notice and you just knock on Greg Sankey's door and say, we're out, you owe the league $45 million. The Big 12, that withdrawal penalty is an amount equal to revenues distributed to the departing member for the final 2 years of its membership in the conference. So essentially in the Big 12, if Texas, for instance, if they were set to make $160 million in the final 2 years of their deal, they would owe that back to the league to get out. Texas and Oklahoma are both paying that and departing for the SEC. I don't know if it's that exact number, but you get the point. It's somewhere up there, right? So they're paying a bunch of money. So what they're arguing is that these fees are excessive. And as a matter of fact, the exact language is, upon information and belief, the ACC's excessive withdrawal penalty is significantly larger than that of comparable intercollegiate athletic conferences as set forth in the table below. So, JC, I know you've been kind of muting and unmuting, being live in the restaurant. But I got to give credit to Clint in our chat box because he did say a little while ago, and this, the common folk like us keep kind of circling the drain and coming back to this point here. Everybody signed this deal. They knew what was in it. I can't imagine that they didn't have attorneys read over this, right? They didn't just have some guy in the athletics department say, well, this looks good, sign off. And I'm not saying that anybody's wrong or right or whatever it is, but there's a reason why this thing is so ironclad, because all these judges are going to continue to look at this and attorneys and say, you willfully signed this deal.
You signed the contract.
I'm not so sure. I mean, you're right, JC, what you said earlier. Generally, league members, they find a way to slither through these things, and I don't know if you'd say they come out on top, but they do work their way through it, and at least something will work out in their favor. But I can certainly understand why there's so much pushback against all of it.
Well, it's become a very limiting partnership for a lot of schools in that league. And it's, you know, the ACC did not have – they panicked, man. I mean, that's what I don't like about it. I know everybody signed it, and it was stupid. You know, Virginia, I know for a fact there were Big Ten – officials on Virginia's campus during after Maryland left, and it was almost done. You know, they were about to go too, and there was talk about Clemson and Florida State going to the Big 12, et cetera, et cetera. The league was about to fall apart. So to save it, they like locked everybody down, and including Louisville. Well, what have they done since then? They haven't tried to renegotiate. They've launched an ACC network, which is not extremely profitable. Probably have to ask Mike more about that. And they've seen these other leagues pass them. And so whose fault is that? Well, you would think the league would be proactive. And maybe they have been. Maybe there's just not a market for it in trying to keep everything going. The other part of this is this. The whole Big 12 – two big dogs and all the little dogs thing was sort of a myth in a lot of ways, because in that league, you have a lot of schools that do care about football and things of that nature. So you do have the Baylors of the world and all that. In the ACC, the other schools, there's schools in there that have done nothing to invest in football, nothing to make the commitment to being good, nothing to up their product, you know? So why should Clemson and Florida State and North Carolina and whoever else cares suffer because other piglets that are suckling from the teat are like, not reinvesting. So that would be my point on that. I think we have a winner. Hi.
You have a winner. Perfect. That's fantastic.
All right, here we go. We got a winner.
Do you have a name?
There we go. What's your name?
My name's Dory.
Dory. Okay. We got
two. All right.
From Lada. From Lada?
Yep.
Okay. Wow.
Yeah, here. Come on over. Get on the air here. This is Dory from Lada. She's our winner. There we go.
Hello. Hey.
There you go.
All right. That's fantastic. Congratulations.
You win the Xavier Leggett signed helmet. It's right over there. Pick it up. Hey, bring that back over here real quick and let's do that. Let me
all right.
Let me show our audience that you have the helmet. Yeah, you get the helmet. That's the prize.
That's okay, really neat.
See, look at this. There you go. There you go.
All right. Yeah, I love it.
See a Garnet nice. Trust.
Congratulations.
I'll get a picture for our archives there.
Oh, so sweet.
Congratulations.
Thank I love you.
It. Do you listen to the show?
Yes, me and my husband listen.
Oh, really? Great. Yes. We love it. There you go. Dory from Atlanta. Outstanding.
That's awesome.
Perfect.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am. Thanks, have a good Dory. Day.
From the great town just up I-95 of Lada, South Carolina.
Thank God. I was worried nobody was going to come.
you worry about that.
You're like,
reach strong.
Yeah.
I probably should have promoted it a little more, but you just never know when you're going. When I'm sitting in Chicago and I know I'm going to be someplace in a week, but it's that far away, you never know what's going to happen.
So it's hard to promote. What did they
back to the subject,
were they already in town, or did they just hop in the car at 11 o'clock and drive down? I can't imagine they
she get said there her she, no, she got a to-go order, so her and her husband listen every day, she said.
Well, that's awesome.
I don't think they drove down from Lada, though. I think she didn't have enough time. Maybe,
yeah, I wouldn't think not. So an hour and 15 minutes, that's moving from Lada.
Well, I mean, she works in Columbia or working or something, I don't know, but
see if you can't dig up her story during the break. How about that?
Yeah, that was
Miss Dory.
Nice. Yeah. So there we go. So Dory, we'll have Alex do a
story on him. Yeah. There you go. Congratulations.
Well, Hale didn't see very much today. Maybe he's not available.
Back to the Clemson thing. Kent says this is all done to find a starting point for negotiating
the way
out. That's true.
Yeah.
Kent's right. That's exactly
I think these schools, just because of the way the ACC has done it and their lack of action on some things and their naivety on some things. I know that everybody signed it. I get that. But I don't think the ACC's incompetence is reason to kill powerful football programs and the schools that make the commitment, because not every school in that league's made that commitment. Not every school has, you know. And so to me, that's – I believe in fairness, and I think fair is fair, you know, when it comes to that. So y'all get mad at me all you want about Clemson and that I'm on their side or whatever, but I am. And I'll just have to live with the consequences of you guys being angry at me. But I think Clemson and Florida State both have a great case, and the ACC, which has been a clown show for years, you know, they're getting what's coming to them.
Well, I think the biggest picture for me here, the biggest issue is going to be the media rights post exit. I think that's the main point of contention here, because that's the biggest dollar amount that's associated with these, you know, teams departing. And if the contract is worded in such a way that the court could rule that the university got to maintain their media rights, then you're probably looking at the demise of the ACC. But I doubt they would come off of the confiscatory, you know, $100 million or whatever it is to leave the conference, because that was probably clearly stipulated and agreed to by everybody. But I think being able to tie up the media rights really is the big question here, and that would be what I'm looking for in these decisions.
And send four of those jokers to the SEC, please. I enjoy. I mean, Virginia is not a bad road trip. Virginia Tech's not a bad. NC State's not a bad road trip. It's hard to squeeze, as we found out this year, it's hard to squeeze games against those teams in when you're playing against all that. But if it's a league game, dude, then heck, why not? I mean, it's one of those things where I wouldn't mind seeing Clemson and North Carolina and Georgia Tech and NC State and Virginia and the SEC. I think North Carolina and Virginia make the most sense in the world for the SEC to expand, because, you know, those are two very large top 10 population states in the South, technically.
Yeah.
I mean, D.C. is not the South. But, yeah, you keep going a little south of D.C. Virginia is Virginia, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Maybe I'm a fool. You talk to old school Gamecocks, boy, they loved going on those road trips up to North Carolina, Virginia, those places back in the day. I think it would be absolutely fantastic, but that's just me. You're going to have to play these people out here that think, why did South Carolina just drop Clemson and quit playing them? They don't need them. That's never, ever, ever going to happen, ever.
No.
Should it.
No.
But if they're a league game, great. Then that solves your problem of too tough of a schedule.
Yeah.
Because the same people that say that are the same people that are too tough of a schedule. So very interesting subject there. It does impact Carolina, because, like you said, JB, we'll probably talk about like where would they probably go. That's kind of up in the air. So but if it's the SEC, it affects Carolina. If it's the Big Ten, quite frankly, it affects South Carolina, because that's a new conference that's able to come into the state and have a foothold.
It's 12:20. We'll certainly come back to this, but we're going to hit a timeout. The voice of Gamecock basketball set to fly to Pittsburgh. Derek Scott joins us next here on ITG.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
The screen, and it goes to Brewer. 20, 15, 10, 5. Touchdown, Brewer. His second of the day. Pitches it to Brewer. Turns the corner. Touchdown, number 3 of the afternoon.
Hey, folks, it's Mike Morgan for Ryan Brewer Fence. That's right. You know the former Gamecock legend as a terrific college football player. Well, I know him as that, too. I also know him as the guy that runs a great business, one of the best businesses in South Carolina. How do I know that? Well, for one, I'm actually a client of Ryan's. I had my home in Columbia done years ago, and his crew did an outstanding job, just as he does for everybody else. Whether you're in the market for a fence, railings, columns, or anything in between, their craftsmanship, their experience, and service second to none. Ryan Brewer Fence has over 15 years of experience with consultation and installation of residential and commercial fencing and railings. Rest assured, your job will be done with an unparalleled level of expertise, and it's done on time, and they do it right the first time. Again, you're not going to do any better than Ryan Brewer, Ryan Brewer Fence. The website is ryanbrewer.net. Set up an appointment today. Tell them Mike sent you.
My company is Billy G's Carolina Barbecue. We are based in Columbia, South Carolina, and we have two lines of sauces and a spice rub. I mean, when people try our product, they know it's a gourmet product and it can go on any type of food. It's not surprisingly delicious. It's expectedly delicious.
Oh, man, the building is on fire.
Emergencies and accidents happen. When you're in the middle of a fire or water event, all you want is for things to return to normal as soon as possible. Resto Pros of the Midlands is with you, guiding you through the process and working with you to get your home or office back in working order. They'll answer your questions, discuss procedures, and can act as your advocate when it comes to processing your insurance claim. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Open 24/7 when you need them. Quality that is guaranteed.
The State Farm Personal Price Plan helps you create an affordable price just for you.
Contact local agent Gary Patterson for your personal price plan today.
Yeah, they're going to try to cut that swag on in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, coming up on Thursday, 4 o'clock, tip, Oregon and South Carolina. Again, congratulations to Dory for winning a signed mini football helmet by Xavier Leggett. Dory is from Lotta, and Xavier Leggett is from Mullins. That's about a 20-minute separation between those two fine towns, so hats off to her for checking in with JC out there at D's Wings in West Columbia. Derek Scott joins us before hitting the skies for Pittsburgh. He'll be calling the opening round and hopefully much, much more after that. And we're glad to have been peppering him for the last 12 hours and trying to get him in. So we've got him, and we're always honored to have you, brother. Congratulations. Another trip to the postseason.
Ooh, been a while between drinks of water. Glad to be back to it, that's for sure.
Yeah, but that's 2 in 7 years. We're making progress around here, man. It wasn't like that for a while.
I wouldn't mind 2 in 2 years. Let's see if we can work on that one this time.
I think that was a really interesting response from Coach Paris last week when we talked to him and asked him about the challenge of winning all these games, all that stuff. He said, yeah, that's challenging, but the real challenge is, can you sustain it? And uh-huh. They're certainly going to try to do that. But the challenge that's in front of them is the Oregon Ducks and a guy that you know well, Jermaine Cousinard, who will come across the country to play in this opening round matchup. The SEC tournament's over. Were you surprised by the 6 seed? Did you care? No.
I won't say surprised, because I always feel like if things change by 1 seed line, you can't be shocked, because sometimes they have to move teams up or down a seed line to fit the rules that they have about not playing a team from the same conference before. I think it's is it the Elite Eight or maybe the Sweet 16. Anyway, they have to avoid certain conflicts, and sometimes that forces them to move one team up or down a line to make it all work. So I'm never shocked by a 1 seed line move. I was a little surprised when they ranked all of the seeds that South Carolina was listed as the last of the 6 seeds. That surprised me. But I thought overall there were a lot of seeding well, I'd call them mistakes. Some people might say, question marks. And seeing what they did to Iowa State, I wonder if maybe South Carolina fell into the same trap in that they really punished Iowa State for their non-conference schedule. Iowa State, in most everybody I know's opinion, people that actually whose opinion I respect, who follow this stuff religiously, Iowa State was in the conversation, or should have been, for the fourth number one seed based on everything they did and the way they finished. I mean, just kick the what out of Houston on in the Big 12 tournament, and they were listed as the last of the four seeds, and that makes no sense. Their resume was so much better than that. That does a disservice to UConn to have the two seed in their bracket be a team that has accomplished as much as Iowa State has. If you're the number one overall seed, you should have the worst of the two seeds. And if you think Iowa State's the worst of the two seeds, then you're not making any sense. You haven't followed things that goes. And I say all that just to say they punished them. The only thing they could have possibly punished them for was a weak non-conference schedule. And I think if that's what they did, then that might explain why South Carolina somehow fell to the last six seed. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense that Gonzaga's up there on the five line ahead of them based on resume. You want to tell me about what they've accomplished in the past, whatever, that shouldn't matter. And I didn't think Clemson's resume warranted them being ahead of us either. But the backside of all that is, six seed playing in Pittsburgh is, I think, very good in that it allows your fans to be there. A much easier path to get people to Pittsburgh from South Carolina than to Spokane or Salt Lake or, a lot of places really that were in play.
I think it's a great point. We talked about some of that yesterday. I was with you. I was surprised where they landed at the bottom of the six seeds, but I was much more interested in what the draw would look like. Now, Oregon, of course, got hot and went out and won the Pac-12 championship. Hats off. It's not an easy thing to do. So congratulations to them. But when you look at that's game one, Derek, but we all do it. We all look at, well, if they get through that, who do they see? And in this case, it would be third-seeded Akron or third-seeded Creighton.
Yeah, we're playing the Zips. I like that. I like your thinking there. I don't have that on my bracket, but I'm telling you, you're going with that.
Third-seeded Creighton, 14-seeded Akron. Yeah.
Derek, you're a Mac guy. How many Akron Zips fans exist?
Oh, there's a fair amount because they've had good success in basketball. Over the last, Keith Dambrock really got it going there. And then John Gross has kept it going there. Gross was at Ohio right after I left and did a hell of a job. Took the Illinois job, bounced back to the MAC. Gross is good. I don't think this year's Akron team is one that's going to scare Creighton necessarily, because the MAC has really fallen off the last few years. If you look where they rank as a league right now, it is stunning to me. That used to be a much better league than the SoCon. When I was at Marshall and we left the SoCon to go to the MAC, it was a big step up in basketball. And now it's completely flipped. SoCon is ranked significantly higher than the MAC. But getting back to your point, there will be some Zips fans there. And I was telling Lamont, who, of course, was an assistant coach there under Keith Dambrot, when it came out, I said, oh, man. I said, how many of your tickets are going to have to go to people who are going to try and call in old Ohio favors for that doubleheader? And he was chuckling. He said, believe me, the phone's already blowing up. As I figured it would. Make sure they wear garments.
Akron is an hour and 46 minutes from Pittsburgh.
Yeah, it is.
So would it be a mini road game for Creighton? I don't know. I my theory is Kentucky's probably bought up all the tickets because Kentucky
will be there for the night session. There's no question. If they had to buy the whole tournament book, then yes, for sure.
I didn't because they do it different. It's not, you'll have different regions both at a spot,
right?
That's how North Carolina and South Carolina were at the same region in Greenville. But when I saw Kentucky, I looked at the other bracket, saw Kentucky, I was like, nah, they're probably going to be the team that's I think that's about a five-hour drive from Lexington to Pittsburgh, so that's not that
bad. And, JC, you know as well as I do, it wouldn't matter how far it is. I mean, half the people in that state take their vacation days from last week and for this week, and then figure out how many sick days they can use if Kentucky makes it to the regions. This is religion there, and Cal's back in his hometown, so you know he will be he'll be riding high. He's a Moon Township guy, so and that's just down the street from the arena. So yeah, it'll be a big blue setting. I'm sure of that, at least for that nighttime.
Well, hopefully it'll be a big garnet and black setting too, just up 77, as John Whittle calls it. Well, it's only about 8 hours up I-77, but John will drive to the moon if you'd let him. It's also a quick, cheap, straight shot flight from places like Charleston. And so hopefully a bunch of Gamecocks will be headed that way. Yeah. So Andy Katz today has the top two first round games that he's interested to watch and see as Clemson, New Mexico, South Carolina, in Oregon. What do you think about him putting the Gamecocks and the Ducks up there?
Well, I've seen in a number of different places that those two games were rated. There's some guys with the Athletic that have their own like system that they use for all sorts of things. And they listed those two games as their two most likely upset games. And they're just basically reflecting what Vegas says. You know, I mean, Clemson is an underdog as a higher seed. South Carolina is only a 1.5 point favorite. Every time I've read it, I just laugh because I'm thinking, I mean, I don't know what's going to happen. I just know what South Carolina has done to Vegas all year. And Vegas hasn't really adapted yet. The Gamecocks have a record against the spread that is way, way above 500. And the goal most years is that most teams, when it's all said and done, most teams are close to 500 against the point spread, whether you had a good year or bad year. And South Carolina is a far cry from that. I was trying to look it up before we went on, and the site that I was using had a mistake, and they were showing last year's record. So I don't have the accurate numbers in front of me, but South Carolina has had a very good year against Vegas. And so I would think that being the case, it shouldn't concern you as much if you're a Gamecock fan. But if you're not a Gamecock fan, and you're just looking at it from 60,000 feet, you see that and say, oh, only 1.5 points difference between 6 and 11. Well, that tells me that could be a really good game.
Speaking of Gamecock fans, we've got one in the chat box today saying that he's got the Gamecocks edging out Iowa State in the national championship. That certainly would be fantastic. So keep wishing that through, BRC. All right, let's talk about Oregon. Yeah. Because we're all kind of just getting to know those guys outside of Jermaine Cousinard. We know what Jermaine is capable of doing. His game has really evolved, actually. He still kind of shoots it about like he did here, but he does a lot of other things much better. He's been playing college basketball for a while. That's not the problem. Nafali Dante is the problem. This kid is a walking double-double. What have you learned about this young man? And I'm not so sure how they're planning to guard him, but I know they've been working on a plan. So what have you learned about him and what he's bringing to this matchup?
Well, I mean, he's you know, like so many people in this game and across the game, whether you're talking about Cousinard, you know, Jermaine's got 25, I think, at least. And when you get guys that have been around the game that long, they develop a polish. And Dante most certainly has. He missed some time earlier this year. He's been back for about 20 in a row, and he has really come on. I think if you look at what he did in the Pac-12 tournament, where he was the MVP of the tournament, and the lead up to that Pac-12 tournament, I think his last five games I saw that he's 43 of 49 from the and I assume that means it's a lot of around the rim stuff, but he's averaging 20 and 10, as you said, pretty much a walking double-double. In that period, and he's very impactful at the defensive end too. He's got, you know, the wingspan, and he's a wiry, strong guy. He's not someone you're moving around very easily. So he will be a definite matchup problem for South Carolina, because BJ Mack isn't necessarily a who handles guys that are bigger than him like that in the post very well. And a lot of times it falls to Colin Murray Boyles, and Colin's going to be giving up, you know, a legit, you know, 4 inches to this guy. So it will be interesting to see how the Gamecocks choose to defend him. And that's really the biggest part of the whole matchup, because Oregon's got some perimeter guys that have talent, but nobody that just knocks you, you know, off the page. They got a couple of freshmen who are in the starting lineup. They've had a ton of injuries. If you go back and look at the lineup they were putting on the court the first week of the season, they got two guys who were in the starting lineup who haven't played since basically five games in. And one's a 7-footer, Nate Biddle. He's played in five games all year. The other is a wing, Jesse Zarzuela, who was a transfer addition for them, had come in, I think, from Central Michigan maybe Coppin State before that. Both of those guys were in five games, started five games, and have not been heard from since. And when you lose two pieces to your starting lineup early on like that, I'm sure it does take a while to recover. And then Dante's only played in 20, I think, of their 34 games. So there was a big chunk of the season where they were missing a lot and having to lean on Jermaine Cousinard to really be the go-to guy. And I'd say that's probably why Jermaine's shooting percentages are still where they were when he was here. I think they've probably gotten better since he got some help back in the lineup. But there was a period of time where everything was running through him. And that tends to deflate your efficiency. But he's playing very well this year. And then the two freshmen that they have, Jackson Shellstad, who was the point guard, and the other freshman, Kwame Evans, who was the more highly touted, honestly. He was a, you know, Dane Altman's done a great job of getting McDonald's All-Americans and national recruits from parts of the country where you wouldn't think they'd end up in Oregon. And Evans was the latest to fall into that category. And he's a skilled guy. His numbers don't jump off the page at you, but he's a guy that can go have a particular, a big game on a given day. If he's got a good matchup or if things are just falling for him early. So that'll be a challenge. They don't have much depth because of all those injuries that I mentioned. They don't have anybody that comes off the bench that scares you. Although I will say this, the Georgia transfer, Okwindo, was a real pain in our butts for 2 years. And I'm almost surprised to see that he's not a bigger part of things for Oregon. Cario Okwindo, he's a dude who's like 6'2", but 220. He's a bull. I remember when we played them a couple of years ago when Tom Crean was still coaching there and they couldn't figure out where their butt was with both hands. Okwindo was the one guy who knew what he was doing. And Chuck Martin, I remember Chuck telling me, he goes, man, that's a dude I wish we had. He would fit in well with Frank's style of play. And I am a little surprised that he's not doing more for them, but doesn't mean he's not capable of stepping up and having a big game.
I just... Off topic here, listening to you talk about some of these players, I hope South Carolina fans are as honored as I am to have you as the voice of the Gamecocks, because I looked at their roster and I couldn't pronounce half their names, and you just spit it out like you've been covering or calling their games for years.
We found out Sunday. That's plenty of time. If I don't have it figured out by Tuesday at noon, what am I doing?
Well, some don't, Derek. Some don't ever figure it out, as you well know. So, you know.
That's right. Sometimes it's a struggle.
I was like, oh, Zarzuela. Oh, Okwindo. Man, Derek's going to have a fun time on Thursday afternoon. But here
I don't leg up on Okwindo because, we saw him for 2 years at Georgia. Because when I first saw that name, when he showed up on their roster the first time, to me, that's Okwindo. Because that's the way the major leaguers pronounced a couple baseball players. Only time I'd ever seen that name. And when they said, no, it's Okwindo, it did take a while to get used to that when he was still at UGA. Interesting thing about how did he end up out there? You know, you think about how do you go from South Carolina to Oregon? How do you go from Georgia to Oregon? Well, of course, we know Jermaine went there because Chuck Martin went there. And Chuck was on staff there last year. That's how Jermaine landed at Oregon. Okwindo's the same situation. Brian Fish was on Tom Crean's staff at Georgia. And he's on Dane Altman's staff at Oregon. So I'm going to guess that Fish had a big part of getting Okwindo to bounce all the way to Eugene. And to take it like round trip for me, when I was at Marshall as an undergrad, and we had a good basketball program, but we were cheating like crazy. And they got caught and went on probation. And they hired Dana Altman to take over. And the thinking was that we weren't going to be punished terribly and Altman was going to fix it. And that's how Altman took the job. And then one season in, they dropped the hammer on Marshall. And basically postseason probation for a couple of years, just wrecked the program. And Dana was gone. And so he only coached at Marshall for 1 year. And Fish was a guy who was on his team at Marshall. So when I saw Fish's name pop up on his staff at Oregon, I chuckled because I would always catch up with Brian when we played Georgia. And just have some good laughs about the good old days back in Huntington at the Henderson Center, back when we were both much, much, much younger. So,
well, it's worked out for the Ducks because look where they are now and playing their best basketball of the year with all these guys. So all those difficult names, this one isn't Josh Gray. His is pretty easy to say. I it just you see these 7-footers on this Oregon roster, it's kind of, you know, it feels like a duh moment to think that South Carolina's 7-footers, I mean, he's going to play on Thursday, certainly, as we well know, but it feels like if he can stay out of foul trouble, he might have a chance to really impact this game. And we've seen him be challenged by guys his size this year, and he has risen to the challenge when he doesn't get a silly hack here and there. So what do you anticipate his role looking like?
Well, I mean, it will be what it always is, and that is to come off the bench early because BJ, you know, you watch what Lamont does. He does not typically stretch his starters out in the early, you know, first half. You'll always see, no matter how the game's going, you're going to see typically by the first media timeout, if not before, you will see Michi and you will see BJ go to the bench, and you'll see early minutes for Josh and typically, you know, one of the other guards, Jacoby usually is the other guy who's first off the bench, and then he starts working through the rotation. Everybody gets a rest. I'm going to be curious to see if that changes at all the NCAA tournament, because the coaches I know in the industry have always talked about the timeouts are so crazy long in the NCAA tournament that you can get away with not subbing as much as you typically do. You can lean on your starters for more minutes because the breaks they get during the media timeouts are extensive. And in the NCAA tournament, that fifth timeout that they take in the second half, the first coaches called timeouts, you know, if you think about it, you get 4 media timeouts in the first half, 4 in the second half, and in the second half, you get a fifth timeout whenever a coach calls a timeout. That flips in the NCAA tournament. The 5 are in the first half. So you really have a lot of downtime in the first half. So I will be curious to see if Lamont maybe leaves his guys out there more. Again, foul trouble can dictate that too. But if he changes that rotation up at all based on the different length of timeouts and then the fact that they flipped the fifth one to the first half instead of the second half.
Wow. See, that's why we bring him in. I would have never even thought of that. I didn't even realize that that was a thing in the NCAA tournament. I didn't realize that they had flipped it like that.
Yeah, I told Casey to dust off his old stand-up routine because we're going to have a lot of downtime for him to entertain coming out of timeouts. So there will be quizzes about counties. There will be, you know, hopefully some great stories from his NCAA tournament time from when he was a player. We're going to dig deep, I'm guessing, on that one.
So don't be surprised if Talon Cooper does 38 and a half minutes.
Talon and Michi, and he's Derek. I think you could probably ask 100 Gamecock fans, and 100 of them would probably say the same name, Michi Johnson. You know, when it's who's the important guy, circle one player in this matchup, in the next, in any matchup that they're going to play in this tournament, his name is going to continue to come up first, at the very least second, because we all know what Michi Johnson is capable of. We all know what his game has evolved into, but he's got to hit shots, Derek. And we all know that in order for them to advance, he has got to hit shots.
Yeah, he does. And, you know, it was strange. His first shot in Nashville, going back to the first game of that tournament, it came out really flat. There was no air under his shot, and he left it short. And it just never seemed to get corrected. You know, he did not look comfortable shooting the basketball in Nashville for either of those games. First day, it didn't matter. South Carolina got so much out of BJ and Colin, it didn't matter. But second day, it definitely did. And you're right, there's a different level of energy on this team when Michi can get it going. And so I am curious. I foresee, at least when the Gamecocks are on defense, Talon Cooper matched up with Jermaine. And Shellstad, the freshman guard, being checked by Michi, both in terms of, you know, I think of Talon being better defensively, and he's bigger. So I think he would most certainly get lined up with Jermaine. But that also means at the other end, if that's flipped, and I think it might be, we'll see. But if it's flipped, does that mean they got a freshman trying to guard Michi? And is that something he can take advantage of with that explosive first step? Or I also wouldn't be surprised if Oregon flips it back the other way and they actually have Jermaine, who's a pretty good defensive player last we saw of him, being asked to take on the responsibility of corralling Michi. So that's going to be a big matchup for sure.
Yeah, Michi, the last 3 games have not been inside of the CLA at Mississippi State and then the pair of neutrals up in the SEC tournament. He's a combined 8 of 36 from the floor and 4 of 18 from long range. And Derek's has been, it's been said around here multiple times this week, and it'll continue to be said all across the country. Guard play matters in this tournament. Yeah. And they've got it with Talon. Speaking of Talon and BJ Mack and Stephen Clark, you know, this is their last dance. Well, literally their only dance, except for Talon made it once with Morehead State. So their first and their last, right? Have you spoken to those guys about this? Because they obviously social media, they've put out some videos and things like that, and Deer Basketball, that was pretty neat stuff there. But these are the leaders of this team, and this is their final crack at really doing some damage and making some noise. What are they feeling going into it?
I talked to BJ on Sunday at the selection party, and he was so excited. I mean, he said, he goes, man, I came here because Lamont and I first talked. He knew I was looking to go somewhere where I've never been in the tournament. You know, I got to Wofford a year late, and then they didn't get it back. And so I've never played in the tournament. And if I'm playing one more year of college ball, I really want to make sure I'm going somewhere where I've got a chance to do that. And I voiced that to him, and he told me that he felt like that if I came to South Carolina, that's the whole purpose of pursuing you, is that we want to get there too, and we think you're a huge piece of that puzzle. So that was part of the agreement back when they were, you know, when we went to Nashville last year for the SEC tournament. Lamont was not on the plane with us because the portal had just opened, and he went straight up to see BJ and his family. And that was a priority, and he wanted to show him what a priority it was, that I'm going to be the first in your door after you've hit the portal, and I'm coming to do it before I'm going to coach in the SEC tournament. And that kind of left a mark on the family, and it worked out for everybody. But there's no question, I know how excited he was about it. And then I'll tell you this too, talking to Michi a little bit, because JC brought up the Akron to Pittsburgh connection. Same thing from Cleveland to Pittsburgh. It's a stone's throw. Michi's going to have his own cheering section up there. And, you know, sometimes guys can get that extra motivation when they've got the hometown crowd. And it won't be hometown, but there will be a lot of folks from the Cleveland basketball community, because his family is so centrally a part of the Cleveland basketball community. It's dad, it's Sonny, those dudes are Cleveland high school hoops. And so I wouldn't be surprised if there's a sizable Michi Johnson fan club at PPG Paints Arena.
I hope you're right. Man, I hope you're right. Well, how far is this from your hometown? How far is this?
I'm at the southern end of West Virginia, so I'm probably four and a half hours from Pittsburgh. So,
oh, okay. Well, do you,
not terrible. I mean, if you want to go, if you're driving it, you know, if you need a break point to go to the bathroom and get something to drink, let me know. I'll have my mom ready to go. She'd love company, you know, because basically you hit West Virginia, you get to Beckley, you take a break there. It's a good split the trip up kind of deal. And then you're back on the road. So 77 up there to Charleston, and then you hit 79. And 79 runs you right up to Pittsburgh.
Yeah, but Beckley's right on 77, right?
Right.
Pretty much.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Well, so what's she sweet tea? Or like, what's she going to have?
That's not the South. You got to remember, sweet tea isn't as much a thing up there.
Raccoon. Hey,
yeah, exactly. We can get you some pepperoni rolls. We'll have you ready to go.
Pepperoni rolls. That sounds fantastic. Derek, what does this mean to you as the voice of the Gamecocks? 2-7 years, like you said, you'd like to have 2-2 or 7-7, however you want to word that. Every year would be nice. Well, Lamont made a great point last week. There was a time when Wisconsin had gone 42 years without being in the dance, and now you can't imagine the tournament without the Wisconsin Badgers in it. And he's hoping to do the same thing for the South Carolina Gamecocks. But that last one was pretty magical. This tournament also is going to end in Phoenix. It doesn't seem like it's been 7 years, does it?
No, it doesn't. But, you know, it's to your point, and what does it mean to me? Well, it was nice in Nashville to have so many people from other schools coming up, you know, other announcers, you know, patting you on the back. Hey, what a great season you guys have had. But the other part of that is when the other shoe drops, it's basically to say they're all shocked. And you want to get to the point that you're Wisconsin and nobody is nearly as excited for South Carolina that they're making the tournament because you're not the underdog anymore. And that, I mean, I appreciate what those guys had to say, you know, and so forth. But Mike Kelly from Missouri and I were chuckling about last year. I was slapping him on the back and this, and you know, trying to get out the door so I could, you know, wrap that season up. And he was in the same boat this year. You know, they were the hot it team in the SEC last year, went to the NCAAs, won a game, I think. And now this year they were just like, where's the door? You know, how quickly can we get out of here and get back home and turn the page? So, and here the Gamecocks are, and you know, with the shoe on the other foot. So it's been fun to be appreciated and to be acknowledged that this team is legit. It's very, very good. And then the other side of it is, yeah, let's get to the point where that's not such a big piece of news, you know?
Mm-hmm. I think it's a great point. I really do. And I think, you know, being able to watch what these guys have done, nobody thought that if you would have asked me, and we'll let you run, Derek, we know you got to go, but if you would have asked me and put these two things together 7 years ago, nobody could predict things like this, and said this 17 team's going to the Final Four, and then this team the year after 11-21 is dancing. Which one are you taking? I said, give me the Final Four all day. Nobody saw this coming. No, I still think that there's people looking at this tournament and trying to figure out why South Carolina's name is in it. And hopefully on Thursday, they'll send a clear, loud message.
Yeah.
The answer to that question.
Well, the Oregon website, when I was over there earlier today, finding their game notes, because they finally got them posted, the landing page for their website has the 11 seed Oregon Ducks against the 16 seed South Carolina Gamecocks. So they don't even have it figured out that we're actually pretty good. I'm sure it's just a typo, but it did make me laugh. Said, man, I thought I was okay with our seeding, but maybe I shouldn't be if this is how it is, you know?
Maybe so slide that to Lamont.
Yeah,
he uses this stuff as motivation.
Oh, I believe me. There's been plenty of stuff on other shows that he's had. He's got plenty of fodder. I mean, Clark Kellogg on the show that night. Clark's the nicest guy in the world, but he just was salivating all over Oregon. And then I was watching some stuff earlier today from last night that had Jeff Goodman, who, you know, kisses LP's butt every chance he gets, and he was taking Oregon. And everybody else on the show with him were falling in line too. So they're a popular pick right now, and I hope Lamont and his staff are able to capture a lot of those clips and share it some new motivation for this bunch that we've gotten it all year from various sources. So maybe they're going to help us out now as well.
Jeff Goodman, huh?
Yep.
I don't care about any of them. To be honest, occasionally the national football media will have something I like to listen to. Rarely does the national basketball media say anything I care to hear them say. It's a terrible. It is the most cliquish sport out there, and you talk about greasing palms and things like that. They all love to do that, and the fact that these brainiacs had anything to do with structuring the net with the Lord Almighty Pomeroy on one hand and, you know, their other metrics on the other and Blue Bloods getting higher ranked in the preseason on the other, they could all go jump, in my opinion. I wanted to chime in and say that here from live from D's Wings. It's Saturday night.
it's Saturday night. Who did Seth Davis pick for in this game? Anybody see?
Nobody knows. But if you want to make some money in the NCAA tournament, fade the heck out of Seth Davis, man. That guy does not make good decisions in the tournament every year.
But hey, he's got. I know he's got chalk in the Final Four. The one year. This year of all years, you're going chalk to the Final Four. I'm like, okay, it's going to be an 11 seed, a 14 seed,
double digits.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it's exactly. You're exactly right, Derek. Thank you for all the time. Really do appreciate it. And safe travels. I know y'all get on the plane in a little while to head to the Steel City. And I hope the Gamecocks are going to be following you heavily up there. We'll obviously have it on 3:30 as of now, right? It should be.
Yep, 3:30 airtime. That's when we'll go. If we have to do an extended pregame show again, we'll have Casey tell people, you know, his thoughts on Permonte Brothers sandwiches, and we'll try and get him out onto the Roberto Clemente Bridge for some selfies. We'll have plenty of content for you. So
that'll be fantastic. Can't wait for the broadcast. It's one of my favorite times of the year to listen to you call the postseason for South Carolina. Man, it's awesome. Thanks
all right,
for
guys. We'll catch up with you next week.
Yes, sir. There you go.
Appreciate you, Derek. Thanks, buddy. Yeah.
incredible voice of Gamecock baseball, and now, of course, the postseason voice of Gamecock basketball once again from the Steel City. So you heard 3:30 airtime, no matter what, even if it's pushed, they will just have an extended pregame show on Gamecock Sports.
Kentucky Network. Gamecock, good to see him back doing well. Explains what a pepperoni roll is, by the way.
Are not the Southern dad watching the kid. They are what miners take in the mines for a meal. We cannot all live in Metro Charleston, South Carolina. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm not so sure that I was laughing at it. I was laughing at his response. But I hear you, big dog.
Hey, you. Yeah. I think he was referencing the cuisine in Charleston.
It's not what we expected, so we laughed.
I was laughing. I thought it was like the pizza rolls you put in the microwave.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that's what Derek meant. Oh, well.
Sorry to offend you there, big dog.
Yeah, mad respect for the miners that eat pepperoni rolls.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
The food for the working man.
Yeah. Well, I beg to differ as well, and you can take a hike. How about that? We got to hit a timeout. It's 12:56 inside the Gamecocks, the show, who doesn't offend anybody. We'll be right back.
I said, oh, Lord Jesus, it's a fire. Ain't nobody got time for that.
Disaster comes uninformed. During and after natural disasters or accidents, there can be a heavy loss to property. Having your home or office destroyed or damaged by water, fire, smoke, or mold affects your personal and business lifestyle. Resto Pros of the Midlands is here to help. Open 24/7. Call them when you need them. 803-493-0170. Resto Pros of the Midlands. RestoProsMidlandsSC.com. Quality that is guaranteed.
Down here in the South, we don't always see eye to eye. While our taste in college football teams, or what sauce, if any, goes best on a rack of ribs, or what to mix with our Dixie vodka might be up for debate, we can all agree there's nothing better than a Southern tailgate. And like our favorite college teams, our ingredients come from small towns and big cities. They're grown in Southern soil, are crafted by Southern hands, and proudly represent the South in our backyard and beyond. So raise a glass of Dixie Southern Vodka to celebrate being made in America and raised in the South.
Welcome home. That's what the Gamecocks say, and so does the Barn Dough Company, where they can build your dream home starting as low as $160 per square foot. If you live in the Carolinas, Georgia, or Tennessee, their turnkey process takes just 4 to 6 months on average and can be custom designed by size and details. Make your dream a reality. Visit thebarndominiumco.com. That's thebarndominiumco.com. The Barn Dough Company, Gamecock, owned and operated.
When you're a developmental program, which all Group of Five schools are, and you lose a great player, that's going to hit you much harder with that next guy plugging in because he's not there yet. He may be there. He's just not there right now.
I just recently reported about, the heart issue that, ultimately let a Big Ten stop or originally decided not to play football. And we had reported out that story, kind of unearthing that it was because of heart issue, potentially with
is that myocarditis?
Myocarditis.
I still had 10 scholarship offers because Chase would go play baseball and I would get a lion's share of the reps in the spring, and they're like, who's this number 17? He's pretty good.
Listen to these interviews and more on the JC and Morgan podcast by downloading the Chief Sports app. Part of the Chief Sports Network.
Gamecock Traditions, South Carolina's elite retailer for anything Gamecock related. The best selection for basketball, baseball, football, tailgating, kids stuff, and everything else. If it's got the Gamecock logo, it's got to be at Gamecock Traditions. Most importantly, they ship it to your doorstep. Order online at GamecockTraditions.com, where there's always a sale. Gamecock Traditions, GamecockTraditions.com. A tradition unlike the others.
So he comes over to me and he says, listen to me. I don't want to hear one more word out of you about my refereeing today. You say one more word about my refereeing, then you're going to be thrown out of this game. And so I turned around to all my parents. I go, hey, parents, I'm not allowed to tell the ref how bad he is, so I'm going to need you to do that for me.
Oh.
He said, you
come. I'm a beggar who could use some help. I'm a seeker searching for myself. I'm a rolling stone just waiting on a friend. I'm a lover wishing on a star for another, with a broken heart to hold each other close till the end.
Nana's Porch, nanasporch.com. At Nana's Porch, they cater weddings, parties, and all kinds of special events. Their meals are served buffet style, and seconds, they're encouraged. Plus, they can bring their mobile food unit to bring on-site and serve your guests as a unique alternative for your catering needs. Inquire about rentals as well. nanasporch.com. Find them on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. 336-259-7550.
Tony Pope State Farm is your go-to agent anywhere in South Carolina, North Carolina, or Georgia for the service you deserve at the price you want. So try combining your home, life, auto, and or small business insurance today. Tony Pope State Farm has been in business for more than 30 years and can handle anything you need in the tri-state area. 843-851-2222 or visit TonyPope.com today. Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
With a little love and some tenderness, we'll walk upon the water, we'll rise above the mist. With a little peace and some harmony, we'll take the world together, we'll take them by the hand.
It's 105. Welcome back inside the Gamecocks, the show brought to you by our friends at Gamecock Traditions. GamecockTraditions.com, where you can pre-order the men's March Madness t-shirts, and you can always stop in and see them in Lexington and the Village at Sandhill as well. GamecockTraditions.com, though, is where you can have it mailed to your doorstep. Gamecock Traditions has you covered for Carolina baseball, Carolina basketball, and always Carolina football. They're the largest South Carolina Under Armour dealer in the state, and we are really honored to work with them, and they make us look good too. Dressing, you know, they give us some good-looking clothes. We hope that you'll all wear that. Maybe you're about to hit the road for Pittsburgh tomorrow. Got an early flight on Thursday. Stop into Gamecock Traditions first and get your gear so you look good as you pull the Gamecocks through against the Oregon Ducks at PPG Paints Arena on Thursday night. JC, Mad Dog, and myself here for another hour. Thanks to Derek Scott and Hale McGranahan for joining us. Hale was just wrapping up spring practice coverage outside of the Steve and Jerry Spurrier Indoor Arena. And, of course, Derek is about to get on the plane with the basketball boys and hit the road, or hit the skies for the Steel City. 4 o'clock tip on Thursday afternoon. Another quick reminder tonight, the first four begins, and whoever wins will be playing on Thursday. Wagner and Howard, 640 True TV, 16 seeds, 10 seeds tonight at 9:10 on True TV. Colorado State and Virginia. JC is live from D's Wings in West Columbia, where during the break he managed to get 12 chicken wings down. 12. in 3.5 minutes. Yeah, looking good. Nice. Oh, is that our? There you go.
There's the inside the Gamecocks. The show banner is flying high, and you got the flags there. There's a bars little section back there, but yeah, it's packed, man. It's going. Lunch is a rousing success, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Today. It's
I hope I get my webcam set back up here, but
that's okay. So you ate 12 wings during the break?
No, I have not eaten. I have. Somebody asked about raw fries earlier. I'm planning on maybe having some raw fries, but no, I got an appointment. I got to skedaddle too right after this. It really sucks. Otherwise, I'd probably stick around and have a little bit of these wings, but it may not work out for me today. But certainly, this is one of my favorite places to come in Columbia, especially when it was over at the old location. I'd go there all the time, and certainly miss it.
one of those places
I miss. So contrasts are they for the wings or the CJC? I think mostly
both.
Wings.
Both.
But I did. Somebody did say they're coming by to buy their wife dinner and to say hello to me. So that's good. You'll get the next gift, which is a Chief Sports app hat, which is pretty snazzy, I must say. So and maybe anything else you want too, because I don't want to carry all this stuff with me back. So anyway, it's a good day out here. D's, of course, we thank them for being a sponsor of our show. It's really great to be aligned with a brand like that. I sort of, all things being equal, love to be affiliated with places that I spend my money at, right? Because I can vouch for, hey, look, I'm down with this. Places like Nana's Porch, Billy G's Barbecue, just about all the places that are sponsors of the show. But having D's as part of it, to me, that's special. As somebody that can flat out put away their chicken wings and their raw fries. I'm tickled to death that they're a part of us. And certainly want to give a shout out to Billy, the owner here, for allowing us to come by and do this today and spend some time amongst the people.
Yeah, no question, man. If you haven't been to D's in a while, obviously you got to go get the wings. But as we've consistently pointed out, everything else is fantastic, from the nachos to the Irish nachos. Just get the app sampler if you want to. Although I will say this, the app sampler, as good as it is, I don't like mushrooms. Are you a mushrooms guy, JC? Do you like mushrooms?
Hell yeah, I like mushrooms.
I don't do fried mushrooms, though. I don't do the fried mushrooms.
You don't do the breaded mushrooms, Phil?
No, I don't do that. I like sauteed mushrooms, but not fried.
Really?
Yeah.
If anything, I'd do the fried over sauteed, but I can't do it. It makes me...
Some people don't like them. Hey,
I don't do it on pizza either. I'm real particular when it comes to mushrooms and pickles, both of those things.
Mm-hmm. Interesting combo there.
You don't like pickles, Phil?
Now, I'll eat a fried pickle.
Yeah.
But I don't do sweet pickles. It has to be like a real salty kosher dill. And not just the stuff you can get at the grocery store. It's got to be some love put into that.
Like a high-end traditional pickle.
Yeah, you got to have a nice high-end.
Your high-end spear, traditional
pickle. Kosher dill spear.
I'm a
pickle elitist. That's what it is. I'm a pickle elitist.
Pickle snob.
So is my wife. Nat does not like the jar. It has to come in that bucket thing that's feels ice cold, that you can cut your finger off opening the really fancy. Nat has to, that's her. It's either those or no pickles at all for her, and she loves pickles.
Yeah, I love pickles. Like the kid from Little Rascals. I got a pickle. Hey.
I'm pro pickle myself, but I like mushrooms too. My ex-girlfriend actually was allergic to them, and like heavily. I went to my aunt's wedding. Somebody forgot to tell her that there was mushroom cream sauce on the chicken. She ate it. Her throat almost closed. Oh, no. I was in no shape to drive her to the hospital. That was a fun night. Anyway, back to the regular schedule programming. But that's fine. So I went through a time of my life where I maybe didn't have mushrooms as often as I should have. But now I'm pro. I'm all about it. I like the fried mushrooms. My pizza, I'll get Italian sausage, pepperoni, mushrooms, peppers,
and onions. Oh, no.
I can't do it.
You don't like the veggies on the pizza, guys?
Not mushrooms.
I don't do veggies, not mushrooms, man.
No peppers on my pizza.
All right. Well,
hey, I'm a pepper snob too. I don't eat green peppers. I only eat red and yellow.
I'm okay. I'm
what
JC.
What the hell is the difference? Phil,
oh, you don't eat green peppers, Phil?
No, I do not eat green bell peppers. I only eat the yellow and red bell peppers.
The green and yellow red bell peppers taste exactly the same. Don't think.
What about a stuffed pepper?
No, I don't do. I
not
don't
if like it's green, peppers. Apparently. It has to be yellow or red.
I don't like stuffed peppers. I've never been a fan of that. My grandmother, oh my goodness, it would be the worst. She would be like, "We're having stuffed peppers for dinner tonight." And I'm like, this is not acceptable. what sides are we having?
I feel that way whenever I hear like chicken pasta. I'm like, oh, God. Sides are we having?
Yeah.
I think I'll just eat this potato salad that I have in the fridge.
When's dessert?
My kids have luckily fallen in line with, they love pickles and they love fried pickles. But luckily they're not into the mushrooms. So I've steered them two directions. You can't wear orange. You can't like orange and you can't eat mushrooms. You can make any other choice you want in life, but those two things you don't have a choice on, and they've done all right.
You've got a no mushroom hard no mushroom policy.
Yeah. I'd almost allow them to, if it was the end of the world tomorrow and they said you can save the world, but yeah, you either have to eat mushrooms with your kid or wear orange. I said, just put the orange on me. I just cannot do the mushroom thing, man.
Just not doing it.
I just can't do it. I just can't do it. Hey, I've got some news here. Some really interesting news, as a matter of fact. And it's coming from a source that many of you probably don't follow on Twitter, or maybe don't check out the website or something like that. But do you remember the former quarterback at Vanderbilt, well, now former quarterback at Vanderbilt, Mo Hassan? Does that name ring a bell to you?
It's familiar. Yes. Yeah.
Mo Hassan, Hasan, is the last name. So he was recently on a podcast called the Momentum Podcast. And I'm trying to figure out here if that is his podcast or not. It is. Okay. All right. Never mind. I've got it now. So he's got a podcast called the Momentum Podcast, and it's former Vanderbilt quarterback Mo Hassan. And just recently on his podcast, and it looks like this was only a couple of days ago, unless he has potentially pulled it down. I'm trying to actually find it on the as far as a tweet goes. Looks like he's pulled the tweet down. So maybe they've deleted the podcast. But anyways, I'm not going to leave everybody hanging anymore. I'm sorry, guys. Former Vanderbilt quarterback Mo Hassan on his Momentum podcast stated that the Italian mob tracked him down in a Nashville bar owned by Jason Aldean and offered him $300,000 to fix games while he was playing quarterback for the Commodores.
Okay, I did hear about this from an unlikely place, how stupid is this?
Well, so here's the thing: a member of the Italian mob, you know, of course, approached him, and according to Mo Hassan, offered this money. He went on to tell the former Commodores quarterback that he had already made deals with Alabama players to encourage him to take the bet. He also pointed out that he had made deals with other players in the SEC, now in the NFL, who had been a part of this scheme. And according to Sports Illustrated, he said, quote, "We regularly talk to guys in your position about fixing games. And of course, since then, there has been all kinds of social media stir up on this. Nothing confirmed, but when a former quarterback from an SEC program announces publicly that they've been approached by the mob in a bar with hundreds of thousands of dollars to fix games, stating that other players, including those at Alabama or some at Alabama, are involved in this, you have to wonder if the SEC has caught wind of this, and if they have, are they going to look into this? Is there anything to it? Is it just a guy who's looking for attention? I mean, I couldn't imagine somebody would come up with a story like this. I guess I could imagine that, but you'd have to wonder and ask yourself why such a thing. But very interesting to hear that.
One of those anecdotes that's, you know, so crazy that it's going to get you all these clicks and looks and listens and downloads, but it's just weird enough to not be able to prove it. So it's, you know, his word against yours. And it's not like anybody from the real mafia is going to be like, yeah, we came up and did this. So I don't know. It's one of those, to me, it just sounds too good to be true. It's too juicy to be true. But hey, you know, weirder things have happened.
Yeah, I mean, again, I guess you probably have to go back and somebody be able to track down who the players were and what games they participated in if you want to somehow have any sort of case for this. But yeah, this, it doesn't look like, it does not look like this is up any longer
thing I can think about it is a Sports Illustrated story about
his. No, it is still up. February 29th. Okay, so it's been 3 weeks. I just didn't realize that this was up, but I just saw this today. Now it's starting to gain steam because it's being picked up by tasteofcountry.com. So yeah, that's something interesting that we'll have to maybe keep an eye on. In the Bruin asset, has he gone missing? That's why he's the probably. I hear you and I understand that probably not the most appropriate time to joke about those things with what's going on in Nashville right now, trying to find somebody. But to your point, I wink and nod, Bruin. He has not gone missing. He's very much alive.
That Leap Day episode, I don't think was the series finale, let's say.
Yeah. Exactly. Sondra asked, how was he supposed to fix a game that he wasn't ever going to play in? That makes no sense. Yeah, I don't know the answer to that, but it's a great question, and maybe it was needing to use him to siphon the cash to other players.
Are y'all talking about that dude?
He's
so terrible. I mean, he's just not even a good player. I mean, it's like the Dartmouth basketball team and the union thing. Like, okay, Dartmouth basketball, we deserve to get paid. Well, you were 10-18 this past year, and you're never on TV. How much do you think you're worth? $30 a game? Dollars?
No,
can we pay you in
$40?
Can you pay half of that in Bitcoin? I mean, right. I don't that same thing with this guy. I was offered to throw a game. Well, you were never going to play. You know, what were you going to do? Were you, I mean, this question would be logical question. Were you the holder? Because that could sway a game, you know. I mean, what, and mobsters running around Nashville? Dude, I lived in Nashville. I've been in all those bars down near Vandy many times. I've never even seen that many Italian folk, man. I mean, much less. And he didn't say mobster. He said mafia. Yeah, like Italian. He said Italian mafia.
In Aldean's bar.
Man. Yeah, yeah, in Jason Aldean's bar. I mean, I'm like, Jason Aldean, badass. I have to tell you, mafia, my bar. Don't do it in my hometown now.
I try that in a small town. Yeah, I'd be more apt to believe it was the Russians than it was the Italians.
I mean, no, there's a lot of Russians in Nashville, and there's Serbians. But yeah, don't you want to stay here a little while, mafia? Don't you want to stay here a little while, badass? Anyway,
yeah, here's the thing. If you start making stuff up like that, and the SEC gets involved, and I'm not talking about the Securities and Exchange Commission, I'm talking about the Southeastern Conference. You better be careful, because you mentioned the name Alabama. That's not going to go over well with the people in Tuscaloosa if you're trying to lump them into whatever scheme this is to drum up attention for your program, if that's what it is. I don't know. I didn't know about any of this till today. But it's now caught the attention of a national publication in Taste of Country, and that's not going to be the first one that's going to pick up and run with this story now that it's gaining some steam. So he better be very, very careful, and he better have some sort of way to back some of this up if he's going to stand on this beat.
They may just kick Nat Vandy on out of the conference. Hey, you need to control your nut jobs. This is
the thing that does it. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the thing
what
that did
they're
it.
They're probably like, what did you think recruiting a quarterback from California like that? There's a bunch of nut jobs out there, you know? Mm. I don't know, man. I heard about that. I didn't believe it at all. I was like, oh, that's the most dumb, ridiculous thing I've ever heard. I mean, you got Vandy football talking about games are being fixed by the mafia. You got Dartmouth basketball demanding to be paid. I'm like, meanwhile, everybody else is just, you know, focused on being good at sports. I'm like, you know.
So, dogs and cats living together. It's
yeah, mass hysteria. So I want to give a shout out to Mr. Wofford, who came by just now with his lovely girlfriend. I had to take a break to meet with them, which was awesome. They got some T-shirts, walked away with some Chief Sports buttons to wear with pride. She went to the selection show on Sunday for the women, and they're looking forward to the March Madness. It's from Lamar, South Carolina, and had on a vintage John Abraham jersey, which I thought was
really cool.
95, John Abraham. So from Lamar, South Carolina, of course. So always good to run into folks, and certainly he listens every single day and really enjoys it. So shout out to him for coming by, because that was pretty cool.
Very cool. Hats off, and a big shout out to two small but great hometowns here in the Palmetto State from two lucky winners today, Lotta and Lamar.
Lamar, home of John Abraham and Tommy Suggs, by the way. Also a Lamar guy.
And Jeff Jeffers, the guy that I played with. So there you go. Jeff is behind a little bit, those guys, as far as legacy goes. But
I remember Jeff Jeffers.
Nonetheless, if you had something to say to Jeff and you said it to his face, you hopefully were prepared to get punched in the teeth, because he would absolutely do it and not think twice about it. All right, we got us. Sorry, Jeff, but hope you're doing well, my friend. All right, it's 1:23. We've got to step aside. Remember, March Madness begins today with the first four. Get your picks in the Chief Sports app. Hopefully, you've downloaded it and you can play along with us in our bracket challenge brought to you by our friends at D's Wings. That's where JC is today for another 37 minutes. So if you're out and about and you're in the area, please stop in and see him. When we return, we'll click back into some Gamecock football, give you a couple of quotes from Shane Beamer today. And then also some South Carolina baseball, as they're set to play tonight against USC Upstate. You got something real quick you need to squeeze in?
Yeah, I know. I know Abraham was born in Timmonsville, but he played for Lamar High School, so we kind of consider.
Oh.
Yeah. We kind of consider where he went to high school the kind of the home when you're talking about athletes, as far as
Yeah.
What we count them as, and I don't know. Was there ever a Timmonsville High School? I don't think so.
I mean,
all I know is they have an airport. Well, it's an airstrip.
This is
Timmonsville.
Yeah, there's a Timmonsville airstrip. Yes, sir.
Wow, I didn't know that.
So, anyway, that's Phil's been all over our great state. We just don't talk about it enough.
Because those are reasons we can't talk about. People don't need to know about Mad Dog's past.
The folks from Lamar obviously are going to claim John Abraham, but you are right. Oh, so the Timmonsville Whirlwind. So born in Timmonsville, but Lamar has to claim him because that's where he achieved athletics excellence. I thought Timmonsville had a high school. Anyway,
well, Timmonsville and Lamar are like 5 minutes apart. I know that.
Yeah. So I wonder if it's a rivalry. Whirlwinds versus
Is it the Lamar Cardinals? Lamar, I don't know.
Anyway. I can't remember. We got to step aside. It is 1:25 inside the Gamecocks, the show built by the Barn Doco. We'll be right back.
Charleston Fitness Equipment is keeping South Carolina in shape. Clients have come from all over the Palmetto State to find that one piece of equipment that they enjoy that keeps them looking and feeling good. Whether it's a home rower, treadmill, elliptical, free weights, a home gym, or something else, Charleston Fitness Equipment keeps the mirror smiling back at you. Get in shape like the Gamecocks do. Visit charlestonfitnessequipment.com. Gamecock owned and operated and proud partners of Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
The preferred sign partner of Gamecock Athletics is Signorama Columbia, and they should be yours too. A full-service sign company that handles design, production, install, and service, Signorama Columbia has helped to bring to life the perfect vision for so many all across South Carolina. Owned and operated by proud Gamecock alumni, they can handle all types of signage, including interior and exterior, vehicle graphics, and more. Go to signorama.com and find the West Columbia location or call them at 803-407-9284. Bring your brand to life with Signorama Columbia and go Gamecocks.
Cold Joe here, and when I'm not eating average jambalaya or celebrating endless summer in Destin, I like to eat pimento cheese straight out the bucket. And the only pimento cheese I like to eat is from Nana's Porch. It's award-winning, it'll melt in your mouth, it's good on a cracker, it's good in a bowl, it's good on a piece of bread. Also, don't forget, Nana's Porch has a hell of a food truck. It's award-winning as well, and they're here for all of your catering needs. So get online, nanasports.com. It's good. Coach O signing off. Endless summer, go Tiger.
For chicken cock, we get a medium to medium plus toast. The char level, we use a number 3 level char. If you char too deep, you start burning away some of those flavor components that you just created. If you just char a barrel and you don't toast it, you're going to create some of those flavors just on a thin layer just inside the char, but not the actual depth and full extent of flavors that you're going to get if you toast it properly. All those elements, that's exactly what they do. They boil down to great flavor.
If you're in the real estate market in the Lowcountry or even in the Midlands, please contact me, JB, with Coast to Coast Realty SC. Go Gamecocks.
This break is presented by Billy G's Carolina Barbecue, the state newspaper's 2023 winner for Best Catering, Best Barbecue, and Best Food Truck. Visit BillyG'sCarolinaBarbecue.com for all of your catering needs.
Ladies and gentlemen, here it is.
Hoop foul, nothing called, drive, bounces down low, shot, Michi will drive, down the corner, Cooper for three, it's up, it's good, Michi from 30 feet, got it, a dominating performance at home by South Carolina. They don't just beat Kentucky, they punch Kentucky in the mouth tonight, folks, and the number 16 in the nation will go down, and they will go down hard.
It is 1:29, 1:30 here inside the Gamecocks, the show. JC at D's Wings in West Columbia. If you can't get over there to see him before 2, get over there to see whoever's there. Get over there to eat. How about that? They will have all the games on. Hey, JC, did you ever find out if they will be also airing the baseball broadcast tonight on ESPN Plus?
The person I asked did not know. Said so to come on up and see if they did. I don't know. My guess is if they don't know, then it's not a common thing. And just kind of being familiar with how that streaming sort of works for businesses, I would be surprised. Just because I think there's like a big upcharge if you stream it to a bar, but okay. I'm not quite sure on that. So I'd give them a call when they slow down a little bit and just see, and maybe they can look and see if they have the channel they can pull up or something.
we will we'll continue to look in on that. It's 6 o'clock first pitch tonight at Flora Field in Greenville, home of the Greenville Drive between South Carolina Upstate or USC Upstate and the Gamecocks. Spartans 14-7, 3-0 in the Big South, hitting .322 as a team, led by Jace Reinhardt, who's a shade under 400 at .398 on the year. Gamecocks all time 15-1 versus the Spartans, won both meetings last year. The last time they played at Flora Field, it was a 19-1 drubbing at the hands of the Gamecock baseball program on March the 8th, so about a year ago. And certainly would like to see that happen again. Cole Messina also went 4-for-6 in that game, and he'd probably like to see that again as well. Carolina's 2.90 earned run average through 20 games is third in the SEC. And how good is the SEC? It is also third in the nation. That means the top three are all out of the Southeastern Conference, which has really, really been pretty wild. Eddie Copper contributing to that earned run average. He'll start tonight with a 2-flat through 18 innings pitched this year, 5 walks and 19 strikeouts. So didn't get to much yesterday on the baseball front for South Carolina, certainly going to try to pepper in a little bit of that here as we start to round things out over the next 30 minutes or so. Phil, I had a conversation this morning with a college baseball coach about what he has seen out of this Carolina baseball program through their first 20 games. And it really is what we've all seen, you know, their lack of being able to produce with runners in scoring position is concerning. And they've got to get that, or with runners on base even, is concerning. And they've got to get that under control. If they can, they're going to be in the thick of everything this year. They've got a chance. But to this point, it's been less than mediocre. It's really been actually pretty putrid, to be honest. And I didn't get to this yesterday, some of the specifics about what happened over the weekend in that series with Ole Miss. But one of the things that, you know, really stood out to me happened in the second game, and it was in the first inning. It was a leadoff double by Kennedy Jones, and then he was followed by Dylan Brewer, Ethan Petrie, and Cole Messina with 3 consecutive strikeouts. And then you go to the bottom of the first inning, and you had a leadoff bloop Judy-style double down the right field line by the Rebels. And what happened after that? A 2-strike, get-me-over ground ball to the right side to advance the leadoff hitter to third base. And then a C&I dog through the 6-hole into left field by their 3-hole hitter early in the count. I think it was a 1-0 or an 0-1 count. It was early. And all of a sudden, it's 1-0 Ole Miss. And then you had a couple of situations that happened a little bit later on where Carolina had a pair of runners on. Tyler Causey strikes out. They can't get anybody. 2 runners on, first and second, nobody out. And they decide to go ahead and let him get up there and rip it, which is fine. And bang, 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 inning over. Ole Miss turns it over, turns it into a big inning, and you could kind of feel it coming, and that's exactly what happened. You got to eliminate that crap. Like, they have got to be able to play fundamental baseball offensively, and they just have not been able to prove that they can do that. Now, they did salvage on the road, and the good news is there's a challenge coming up. The bad news is there's a challenge coming up. So if they can get things fixed, the next 15 games in the league, like, if they can somehow maneuver their way to like a 9-6 league record over the next 15 games, oh, you know, you're cooking. I mean, you're sitting there at 10-8, and that doesn't sound fantastic, but I can tell you this, if you win 9 of your next 15 against those 5 teams, you are by far a top 16 national seed. He's got to play at home, and you're going to have to find a way to get 6 more wins when the schedule lightens up. It's pretty easy to figure it out. But that's what we're seeing, and hopefully tonight maybe their big stars can show up and kind of crack out of it. Cole Messina is in a deep, dark slump, and he's got to find his way out as soon as he can.
Yeah, and I know last year he had a heck of a game here in Greenville. I mean, he hit one that cleared their little green monster that we've got downtown And didn't look back. Heck, I think it hit the side of the building where the apartments were. I mean, you got to hope that up against Upstate, you know, here where, you know, a majority of this team played last year, had some really good success at the plate, will be able to find something. I was hoping that that game three was going to be that spark, right, where they just, it just kind of hit them, you know. It was like, okay, now we know what we're doing. But you got the runs early, and then towards the end of the game you were still having the same issues that we've been seeing all year. I mean I don't know, it just, I was talking with JC, we were watching the game together this weekend, I think it was game two, and I'm just like, these guys get up there and it's just like, you just need a knock. Just knock it over the, just knock it over the infield's head, let it hit the grass, and get this guy in from second. I mean, it, you don't have to send one to the moon every time you get up there with guys in scoring position. Sometimes it's just about advancing runners and being able to get guys across the plate when it comes, especially in these conference games where runs are at a premium, because you know you're facing the best damn arms in the country.
Yep. There's no question. I mean, they've struggled in that department greatly. Bill's right. I mean, it is boring to watch when you run out there and strike out 12, 13 times. I mean, if you think, you just, to put this in perspective here, just think about this for a second, right? Think about this. You've got 27 outs in a game. And you're now, they only struck out 7 times on Sunday. But if you, if you're rung up 12, 13 times, and half of those are looking, how many scoring chances, how many possibilities of being able to be successful on offense you're eliminating by not putting the ball in play? I mean, there was a Kennedy Jones with 2 strikes the other day, hit a ground ball back up the middle. Not an easy ground ball, but not a difficult one. But what's the shortstop do? He boogered it up. Now, I think they gave Kennedy a hit on that. But that's what happens. When you have 2 strikes, you've got to have an approach like that. You've got to be able to put the ball in play and put some pressure on the defense. And they just haven't done it enough. So they got to get going in that department.
Well, look, it's disheartening, too, because you can't even get excited about a rally. Like, get run 2 runners on, nobody out. And you're sitting there waiting for the other shoe to drop. Now, even when your alleged all-star players are up at bat. So from an observer standpoint, it sucks. It has to suck in the dugout, confidence-wise. You know, and look, Whittle said this. It's simple. The ballers need to ball, okay? Ballers in baseball sometimes go through slumps. They all, even the great ones. Let's just hope that the slump happened at the beginning and that this is not a slump-filled year, a sophomore slump for Petrie or something. I mean, you got to find your way out of it, and it's got to start soon.
Yeah.
You know, because right now this team is not tracking to do very much. I think if certain guys do step up and start becoming their old selves, then this team could go – further than we expect, because the pitching is much better than we expect.
No question. So
it's just got to be that way. You can't, and if you're Mark Kingston, I don't think you can sit around and wait forever on it. I think at some point you got to make some changes, move some people down the lineup, move some new people in.
He did that
to a certain extent Sunday, and it worked out pretty well, because if you talked to us all offseason about how deep of a team you are. Well, that means if some people are struggling, I don't care what their names are, they need to kind of maybe see some pine time or get moved down to the order, because I know that getting moved down to the order sometimes as a baseball player really hurts your pride, right? So it maybe makes you refocus. So, and I'm not saying that Petrie and Messina aren't focused. I'm saying this happens sometimes to players, and, you know, maybe – for different reasons they're struggling right now. But the bottom line is, I don't care what the reasons are, you know, unless your leg is broken and you have gangrene in it and that's the reason you're not the same hitter you were last year, you need to find your way back to Quan. You need Bagger Vance to come, Will Smith to come walk 18 with you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the thing, I mean, is about
whatever needs to happen.
Well, and about moving guys in the lineup, like I you're not wrong. Like certainly some guys, you know, if you're used to being the three hole hitter and you just can't get out of your own way and you show up to the ballpark and you're hitting eighth, that's a telltale sign of, hey, you suck. I'm trying to put you in a spot to get to allow you to see some better pitches, get some better swings on this thing, get you out of it. Good hitters understand that's temporary. Bad hitters don't. But also, there's some guys, JC, like, who are just more comfortable in certain spots. Like, I can tell you a bunch of guys, and I mean, I was one of them, I remember at one point in time, I hit the middle of the order for a while, but in college, that's where it started. I was not comfortable there. I was much more comfortable hitting in the 6 or 7 hole. I just was. And some guys are just more comfortable, but it's easy for coaches. Like when you have a lineup that's struggling to score runs collectively, it is very easy to take the hot 6 guy, the hot 7 guy, and move him up. It's very easy to do that because you think that that's going to be the fix for the lineup. And I'm not saying, by the way, I'm not saying that that's exactly what Coach King or any of these guys have done. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just speaking baseball stuff here. But then what it will do sometimes is it creates a hole. Now it creates a problem in the 7 hole and the 3 hole. Or now it creates a problem in the 7 hole and the 2 holes. You take a guy who's comfortable hitting 7th, make him uncomfortable hitting 2nd, and then the guy who's hitting 7th can't hit a lick anyways. So now you got 2 problems. And then now you're like, well, you know what? Let's just put this guy back in the 7 hole and let's try to figure out the 2 hole again. So you start chasing your tail a little bit, and that's where you go back into the.
No, go ahead.
No, you're good. You're good.
No, I kind of like putting Blake Jackson at the top of the lineup, but I know he's struggled at times, but he's a catalyst guy, and you know, to me, and like I said, I'm no baseball expert. You know, I thought it was the subtle move Kingston made was positive. Because I think all he did was put Kennedy in between Petri and Messina, right? Petri moved to 3, or Petri stayed at 3. Kennedy Jones was at 4, and Messina went to 5. You know, I don't know that maybe the 2-hole you don't need to look at it, move Nolan down, maybe throw Talmadge Lee Corey toward the top, you know, so those guys can set the table a little bit. I don't know. The problem with Petri this year is he's getting the dingers. But he's not, you know, what made him great last season wasn't necessarily all of his home runs he hit. It was that, hey, if he didn't get a home run in a clutch situation, chances are he's getting a single or double. You know, that to me makes him a feared hitter. You know, home run or bust guys are out there a dime a dozen. But, I don't know. I don't know what needs to happen. But I like Blake Jackson being back at the top of the order. I think he's just kind of one of those spunky guys that can make things. He's kind of a catalyst type guy.
Well, I think it's pretty clear that the best lineup that they can put on the field is one that has both Kennedy Jones and Blake Jackson in it. Now, whether that means that, you know, they have to DH Petri or they have to DH Jones or whatever. I mean, Petri played a pretty salty right field on Sunday in game 3. He made some, I guess both Saturday and Sunday, he made some outstanding catches. One of them, he went right into the wall. I mean, they've got, the thing is your 4 best guys out there, you've got 4 spots to put them in, but it's going to eliminate somebody. Now, who's that going to eliminate? Is it going to be Tyler Causey? Is it going to be Gavin Casas? You know, I don't know. I don't know the answer, but I do know this. At the end of the day, this lineup has got to produce. And if it produces, but you got to take one of your biggest, most feared hitters out of it in order to do that, then you got to do it. It just is what it is.
Unfortunately, I think it's Casas right now, and I think Causey has to move down. This is just my opinion. I'm probably wrong, but I would. So if you move Casas out, would you have to? You'd have to move somebody to first base. Like Causey would
play
first base.
It's Causey. So it's Causey.
DH would be open.
You would DH Jackson Kennedy. Or you DH Kennedy Jones or you DH Petri and then play those guys in the corner.
See, I'd start putting Bakes in there at some at DH or something.
Well,
if you're not hitting the ball. I mean, you need somebody that, you know, you got to put, if he is one of your best hitters, which they say he is, then they need to play. I mean, how
he didn't surprise me to see Bakes behind the plate tonight. Messina over at first, and then a shakeup at the DH spot, just to kind of try something different in the midweek against a lesser opponent.
The problem is you absolutely cannot have Messina not catch your starters or your frontliners because he's so good with the pitchers.
No, I mean, you've got to have him on the weekends. Yeah, there's no question about that. You want to be solid as you can up the middle, right? I mean, it's one of the reasons why you're – You know, I think you're kind of – it's a give and a take with Brewer playing center right now because he has been, you know, productive at the plate when, you know, arguably, Stone might be your best center fielder, like just, you know, pure guy out in the middle in the outfield. But his bat is just not where it needs to be. And you're going to have to sacrifice a little defense if your offense is really, really struggling, in my opinion.
Yeah, and look, I don't think he's just going to sit around and sing Kumbaya and sacrifice a live chicken to try to get these guys to go. He's going to make some moves, right? You know, so – and I don't know. That's just kind of where – that's my amateur opinion on it. But, you know, I just – They just need to hit the ball better. That's bottom line.
Well, it's been very disappointing. Guys, I got news for you. Bakes ain't the answer. Bakes is hitting 200 on the season. He's had one hit in a month. You know, yeah. I mean, it's not about plugging guys like that into the line. It's about guys owning their role. I mean, the thing that works so well under Coach Tanner, and this actually worked really well offensively under Coach Holbrook, was guys knew what their role was and they owned it. And it was okay for guys to come off the bench. They accepted that. I am here when you need me late in the game, and they're still trying to figure out all those roles, which isn't really unusual. I mean, that does happen. The problem is they haven't been producing, and so it really magnifies itself. So, you know, we'll see. But Blake Jackson probably needs to be in the lineup, and Kennedy Jones is going to stay in the lineup. He's the best hitter on the team. I mean, that's point blank, crystal clear. So those guys, you're going to have four outfielders in the lineup every game. I mean, they just got to figure out where they're going to hit. Blake Jackson probably should be the leadoff guy, but he's going to have to get up there and own the leadoff spot. And Parker Nolan should be your two hole. They had it right at the beginning of the year. Parker Nolan's a two hole hitter and Blake Jackson's a leadoff hitter, but you know, it wasn't working out like that. So we'll kind of have to see where it goes. All right. We got to hit our final timeout. One other quick baseball nugget. Expecting to see Michael Polk tonight. That is a big deal for this pitching staff. Big right-handed transfer from Georgia is on the mend and finally getting healthy. They're expected to throw him for an inning tonight. When and where he gets in there, I don't know. But I can tell you this, it is a big deal for this bullpen in April and in May and hopefully in June. If they can get him right, having him and Garrett Gainey hard throwing righties and lefties at the end of this sucker deepens those setup man type scenarios for Chris Veach when they've got a lead. So big deal to see Michael Polk tonight. JC's live from D's Wings. If you're in the area, you've got 12 minutes. Yeah. The 12 minute challenge to get in there and eat 12 wings. And JC will give you a hug.
Had three people stop by. So great. Yeah, three couples. So our wife and two couples. So that's also not bad for not bad. Plus the place was packed. So I brought them some good luck today. So yeah, definitely. And I'll give you a hug if you can come finish 12 wings in 11 minutes. By the way, they March Madness, they did the mixtape. They did everybody's favorite music, every coach. Lamont Paris is Tupac. Not a surprise. If you didn't listen to our interview with him the other day, you may not think so. Oregon coach Dana Altman, the Eagles, Rick Barnes, Kerry Underwood. Brad Brunell, Chris Stapleton. Very interesting there. You know, I'm trying to see that Luke Combs is here. TJ Ulsterberger of Iowa State, Ed Sheeran. Bruce Pearl, Kenny Chesney.
Yeah.
Andy Kennedy is Bob Marley. I think that's amazing.
All right, let's hit our final timeout, and we'll be back to start to wrap things up here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.
Mike here for one of the better dining options in the capital city. You know, when I first moved there, I asked people around the radio station, where are the best wings? Well, the consensus was D's Wings. That was then. Today, they still have the best wings, but it's so much more now in their new location at 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia. Yeah, they get voted the best wings on a routine basis. Yes, they get voted the best sports bar on a routine basis, but they're not just about wings, and really, they're not just a sports bar. It is a family-run local restaurant and bar with 20 TVs and 25 beers on tap. And how about these daily specials? Every Monday night at D's, you've got 75-cent wings from 4 until closing. Tacos on Tuesday. Then on Wednesday, 18 wings and a pitcher of beer for $29. You've also got ribs and oyster bucket specials on Thursday. And no matter how big the party is, 20 or more, no problem. Just call ahead of time and they'll take terrific care of you. They'll do takeout as well. And guess what? A human will answer the phone and take the order. Billy and his staff do an outstanding job. Check out D's. 415 Meeting Street in West Columbia.
Don't miss this, the final taping of season one of the Southern Songwriters Series with Patrick Davis is Friday, March 22nd in the Chappelle Auditorium at Allen University in Columbia. Patrick will be joined by renowned national artists and songwriters David Ryan Harris, Sean Mullins, and Drew Holcomb in this national made-for-TV event that will be broadcast on over 300 stations in the U.S. this summer. Tickets are available at SouthernSongwriters.com. VIP and general admission seats are available but are moving quickly. Go see one of South Carolina's proudest musical sons, Patrick Davis, alongside a national cast of elite performers. Visit SouthernSongwriters.com. That's SouthernSongwriters.com. The Southern Songwriters Series with Patrick Davis, Friday, March 22nd at Allen University in Columbia.
Tartan Day South, built by Culpeper Wood, is the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Friday, April the 5th, three great Celtic rock bands perform at the Lexington Amphitheater. Saturday, April 6th, it's the main event at the historic Columbia Speedway in Casey, featuring Highland Games, Celtic dance, music, and food, featuring exhibits like sheepdog herding, birds of prey, and classic British cars at the largest Tartan Day celebration in the Southeast. Get your tickets now at TartanDaySouth.com.
There's a high drive. That ball is tagged. That ball is way, way, way out of here.
Sure look good.
Look good and you know it.
But you know it, know it.
Look good and you know it.
Yeah. Look good and you know it.
Church, 154, final segment here on Inside the Gamecocks, the show. JC, Phil, a couple. Yeah, go ahead, man.
Yeah. Oh, go ahead with a couple.
Oh, I'll just say a couple quick notes from Shane Beamer today. Although they're not giving this job away, it's March. They don't play till August. But he did say that Alex Herrera is the starting place kicker coming into spring practice. Daniel Lester, he said, certainly took some kicks today, but Alex Herrera, based on what he's done here, is the starting place kicker. Of course, Mitch Jeter decided to go. Where did he end up? Notre Dame, right?
The University of Notre Dame.
Yeah. So he's out
that was
here.
Beano Cook in person.
Shane, by the way, backing up some of what Hale McGranahan mentioned just a little while ago, and that Joe DeCamillis on the field alongside Sean Elliott is pretty loud, and they will essentially get in your rear end if that is what is required. And so that's good news, certainly. You felt didn't you feel a little bit in the offseason, JC, like this team? No disrespect at all intended for anybody that's not any longer with the program. I don't mean it like that, but you did kind of feel like maybe they were missing some of that. And these two guys certainly bring that heat, no doubt.
Never been a good Gamecock team in any sport that wasn't tough and resilient. So yeah. I think any kind of additional toughness and resiliency is a welcome development. So, you know, that's the deal there. All right, so SI ranked every mascot in the NCAA tournament. Illinois San Diego State do not have school sanctioned mascots because they're, I guess, Native American, whatever. They didn't want to. I mean, you know, Aztecs didn't wear that many clothes either, so it's probably maybe some sort of nudity law that came into effect there, even though it is California. So the dead last mascot in the whole thing is the tiger from Clemson.
Really?
Dead last.
As it should be.
Yeah, it's like, look at his eyes. I beg you, look at his eyes. The tweaking tiger. He's definitely on meth. And then 65 is my favorite mascot, Purdue Pete. It's a strong candidate for the position of last thing you see before you die. Oh man. Oh, it's like, oh, whoever wrote this is a genius. So I was like, wow, that's pretty cool.
That was who did that? SI?
Yeah, Sports Illustrated. Cocky's 22nd. He says Cocky has strange body architecture, and it's impossible to say whether or not he's wearing pants. So the number one is Zippy from Akron.
Really?
Zippy is, I think, a she and maybe a kangaroo. I'm not sure. Let's look it up. I thought Akron was a, yeah, it's a weird kangaroo.
Yeah,
they are.
Kangaroos. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Zips. And it's a woman. It's a female, I think. Because it says it's she. So she's an icon. She's a legend. Big Red from Western Kentucky's number two. That's awesome.
Okay, that's what I was wondering where Big Red was, because he's
Big Red's good.
One of my favorites. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm a Big Red fan. I like Big Red.
I don't know, man. Arkansas had this inflatable hog at the tournament that was hilarious. Because the dude goes out there and dances and gets everybody fired up, and then toward the end, he was over there just sad and hanging his head and over in the corner. Full of shame, and I was like, that's amazing. I took a picture of it. It's on our Instagram account, hashtag sad hog.
It was funny.
Arkansas fans, amazing. I love them, but I got the oldest, grouchiest Arkansas fan ever that sat in front of me. I told you about it. Say, Sam Fallon, our players, man. What are you going to do, South Carolina, number 20? What are you going to do, number 30? What are you going to do? Over and over and over. Anyway,
I digress.
So glad Purdue Pete. I'm glad the Tigers last, but the fact that Purdue Pete is right in front of him has made my whole day.
Yeah, but that feels very validated.
Yes, I feel validated. Mm-hmm.
Well, the Clemson Tigers' eyeballs look methed out. I've always thought that.
He's a tweaker, dude.
Yeah,
does all those? How do you think he does all those push-ups every game? Push-up. Oh yeah, let's roll.
Yeah, it looks like somebody was invited to create their own Muppet. You know,
it's like activity at Pendleton High School. Somebody did this. Yeah. They put it together in the 50s and just never went back. They never updated it.
Well, no, that's the dirty little secret is that they get Pendleton, elementary schoolers or whatever to recreate a new one every year, and that's what it turns out to look like.
Yeah, it's just like, man, it's like, wow, you know, it's like, hey, what's up, guys? He looks like all these guys. It's like if you met him in person, you know, unlike like Tigger who bounces, he's like, hey, how you doing? You want to hang out? Hey, you want to go back to my dorm and do some meth? Man, I'm running out of this hill right now, do some push ups. Yay, orange balloons. Yeah.
On that note,
hey, you want to go to the sheep farm? Sheep farm's awesome. Oh, you ever been to the sheep farm? Tell Timothy, let's go. Yay.
Resto Bros of the Midlands.
Well, I love you. I love our Clemson audience, but just gonna let everybody know.
Fantastic people. Resto Pros of the Midlands presents our coverage of Gamecock baseball all year. Resto Pros MidlandsSC.com. After that comedy skit by JC, if you set your house on fire, good news. They're the ones who will come clean it up for you. Resto Pros MidlandsSC. Water, smoke, fire, wind, hail, you name it. Nobody wants any of that, but it happens. And your business too. Jeff Sturgis is an awesome, awesome dude. Man, I'm so happy we partnered with him. Thanks for what you do, Jeff, for all the Gamecocks in the Midlands and South Carolina. Resto Pros MidlandsSC.com. Jeff says, go Gamecocks. JC is wrapping up from D's Wings. If you head by there today, let them know that you heard about it here on our program. Can't thank you enough for supporting our partners. But they have great foods. We understand why you would. Great work today, my man.
It was a lot of fun. Don't forget, you're not going to have me tomorrow, most likely, because I'm going to get my butt back to the frozen north. And then you'll see me Thursday. I'll kind of be very distracted and probably won't have a good show Thursday because I'll be so nervous about this one. But six times in a lifetime, man, when your favorite team's playing in a tournament, it does get tense. So so happy that they're in and going to be worried about them losing from now till the next all the whole way home and once we get back.
Can't wait. We are 50 hours away from tip-off of Gamecock basketball versus the Oregon Ducks. Just 4 hours away from first pitch tonight in Greenville. Those headed to Floor Field, enjoy. A reminder, you can catch up on the Gamecock Sports Network, Cade Crenshaw, Stuart Lake, 5:45 airtime, ESPN+. If you're watching on TV, I'm going to remind everybody, as we do every single time it's in a minor league ballpark, it is not going to be a good broadcast. Please do not complain to us tomorrow. There's nothing we can do about it. Listen to Cade and Stuart on the broadcast. Yeah. On the radio, if you don't want to watch it on TV, it is not going to be very well done.
No, or if you're relatively close, it's only $12 a ticket. Come on out and, you know.
Yeah, there you go. Even better.
Go have you a beverage. Meet Phil.
Go meet Mad Dog. Meet Mad Dog and Dina. It'll change your life. I promise you. All right. For JC and Mad Dog Mullinax, thanks to Derek Scott and Hale McGranahan for joining us earlier. Make sure you downloaded the Chief Sports app. Participate in our March Madness Challenge on the app. Get your tickets to the Southern Songwriters Series on Friday night, all right there in the Chief app. We'll see you tomorrow at 11 on Inside the Gamecocks, the show.